nearby.
Hello and welcome on this somewhat miserable winter's day. We have the most incredible thing to show you. You're on a live safari from the middle of the African bush in the center of Juma, actually, with the royal family contentedly sleeping off a meal. And can you believe it? You are watching a leopard family plus sleeping cub off to the right from all four corners of the globe, which is an expression I have never understood, and yet this is a concept that continues to blow my mind every time I think about it. It's absolutely extraordinary. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have dazzling Dave on camera with me, and we're terribly excited. This is the first time I have seen Queen Karula's cubs in quite a few weeks, and I just can't believe how big they have grown. Now, you're not only on a live safari, but it's also interactive, which means you can send through your questions on hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv, and please do send through your comments, even if it's sort of exactly what I'm thinking at the moment, which is, oh, cute. Aren't they just incredible? Now, Mr. Henry has very generously afforded me the opportunity to come and spend a little bit of time with them, since it has been so long since I've seen them. And I've just worked out where the other one is. I was trying to work it out earlier. I can't believe I didn't spot her or him. I'm not sure which is which at this point. If we have a look in the tree, the large tree off to our left there, and we zoom in, there's a little bit of movement. Go up a little bit, Dave. There. There she is, right in the center of your screen. I don't know if you've spotted her yet. Him, her, it. There's another little leopard cub, making short work of mommy's kill that she's very cleverly stashed away in the tree. Who have we got here? It looks like the female to me. Karula's little female cub. Now, if you are joining us for the first time, Karula is the most extraordinary mother. She's 12 years old, and this is her latest litter of cubs, a boy and a girl. At this point, how old are they? 5 months old already. This must be, no, there must be, what's today, the 2nd? It's today the 2nd. It's the 2nd of July. They were born on the 2nd of February, so today is their month birthday, if we could call it that. Oh, yummy. Afternoon snack on this cold and windy day. And the weather here, I have to say, is truly revolting, but that's okay, because a sighting like this makes everything absolutely extraordinary. Moments like this just remind me of how extremely fortunate we are to spend time watching the lives of these fascinating creatures. Yummy. Amazing. 5 months old and totally weaned. Oh, look at those claws. Can you see them there? Coming out. Already equipped with the tools that they will need once they reach adulthood. I have to say, there's something extraordinary about this little girl. I think it's just because we've seen them from such early stages of their lives, and it's her incredible brown eyes. I've never seen a leopard cub with such almost, I don't know how, chocolate-coloured eyes. It's going to mean she will be forever easily identifiable. And this morning started off with an extraordinary moment where I saw the aunt. Have I got that right? Wait, not aunt, sister. She's their sister, sorry. Familial relations with leopards tends to get a bit confusing, because we saw Karula's nearly 10-year-old daughter, Tundi, her oldest daughter, this morning on Cheetah Plains. Oh, look at those little canines. I'm a fierce predator, or at least I'm going to be in a few months' time. So while we think about shuffling around and getting a close look perhaps at the royal prince, Let us go across to the wonderful Mr. Henry so that he can say hello to you all. And in that case, never mind then, because James has disappeared off the radar. Never fear, I'm sure he is absolutely fine. He is on Wendy. Wendy, as you, most of you know, Wendy's the other vehicle. This is Rusty. Rusty is very reliable, except for this morning when we went out. But that all that required was a restart. But as you know, Wendy has her, the places where Wendy doesn't want to go. And Wendy just doesn't go in those directions. What we'll do is you can accompany me as we reposition ever so slightly. So what I want to do, obviously I don't want to disturb the little boy that James has unofficially named George. And the girl is called Charlotte, because James apparently is something of a closet royalist. We're going to reposition, but you can go with us. No, you can't go with us actually, because it turns out Mr. Henry has decided that he would in fact like to say hello to you, and at this point Wendy agrees with him.
I mean, I've never been called the wonderful Mr. Henry. Oh, for God's sakes. Hello again, everybody. I feel like I'm going to be saying hello again 4 or 5 times today. I'm just going to drive this car into a hole and burn it to the ground because it is so deeply irritating. Okay, I feel better now. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to our little drive. Jamie, of course, with the beautiful leopards, and we driving around in what can only be described as a howling gale. It is coming from the southeast. It has brought with it a bank of thick clouds, and as you can see around us from the great teeming herds of animals, everything is going to be hiding in the wind like this. I suspect there might be one or two things that might want to come down and have a drink, so we're going towards Bivelshoek Dam. My name is James Henry. On camera today is Viam. There he is. And we are as live as Jamie is, and therefore please do talk to us. Hashtag SafariLIVE or questions at wildearth.tv, and we'd love to answer any questions that you might have. We're probably going to be looking for the smaller things today, I feel, because the big things are going to be hiding away in the bushes. It is a very kind of eerie gunmetal kind of a winter's day, this. And I quite like it once in a while, I must say. Every so often it's quite good to have this sort of weather. Then it must go away again. We'll have another 2 or 3 weeks of plain blue skies. That'll be beautiful. But then it can come back again. It's a kind of weather that does make you want to curl up in front of a fire. And that's certainly what we will do later on today. But of course one must reward oneself after a stringent day out in the wilderness. And that is what we'll do later. Now we're approaching Bivelshoek Dam. Where, with any luck, there will be a great plethora of surprising animals not hiding from the weather. That lion we saw today, I don't know if you were with us this morning, we saw a lovely male lion, and he was lying sort of resplendent in the sunshine this morning, and then Herbert went back to look for him just before we went on drive, and he isn't around anymore. He's decided that he's had enough. And I suspect he's gone into the thick drainage line, to the thick bush, where he can lie amongst the leaves and shelter from this fairly stiff southeaster. Very dry kind of weather this. I know it looks like it might be wet, but it's, this wind is quite desiccating. So everything feels kind of dry. Hippopotamus absent. Everything absent. Anyway, we'll drive onto the top of the wall and see what we can see here. Oh, look at that, Viam. One impala, one waterbuck. Good. It's a good start, especially on a day like today. A waterbuck bull, an impala ram. Hello, Oki in Oklahoma. Oki from Oklahoma. You want to know if that waterbuck is on the menu for any of the predators out here? Okay, yes, lions especially. It is said that they are not edible because of the very strong musky glands that they have under their skin, but I think the lack of, or the infrequency with which we see them being eaten has far more to do with the fact that they are very big and they have those rapier-like horns, which means that if they anything that wants to eat them has to be sort of lion-sized or at least very large hyena-sized. And so yes, they will be eaten by lions and spotted hyenas, but not very frequently, and perhaps there's a certain amount of deterrence because of that musk gland, but certainly you will find that lions eat waterbuck very happily. And I think these two males are hanging about with each other for safety. I'm not sure why this impala should be on his own. It's a little bit odd, but see how he's going to see his new friend? And they'll probably go off into the woodland together, both of them hoping that the other will be eaten. As we do that and the impala disappears, let's go back to Jimmy Patterson and the leopards.
Some very sleepy leopards with very full bellies. Now, since Karula's been showing us her cubs, we actually haven't stopped to really appreciate, well, I feel like I haven't really stopped to appreciate what an extraordinary animal she truly is. Now, this leopard female probably has one of the highest success rates of any leopards most of the guides have encountered in terms of raising cubs to adulthood. Well, a typical leopardess has all kinds of struggles facing her, and there's a sort of standard mortality rate of about 70% of leopard cubs that do not make it beyond 1 year old. And yet somehow Karula has defied the odds, and at 12 years old she's done the most extraordinary job. At the moment she has two very healthy little babies. And if we have a look at our little princess up in the tree, she is currently devouring the dacre with great enthusiasm and an appetite befitting a little leopard cub that is well on its way to growing up. She's managed to reposition, can you believe it, she's repositioned that whole carcass to get to the part of the meat that she wants. The jaw not yet quite strong enough to crunch its way through, but nevertheless making short work of whatever she can find. There's something so cute about that. Yes, you're going to move it, just be careful. You and the carcass could go tumbling out of the tree. And 5 months old already with the established spot patterns that she will have for the rest of her life. The spots will never change, and each and every leopard has their own unique fingerprint-like spot pattern. And I think she's got a W on her forehead. Her mom has the word wow written in her spots. I think the little female has a W. And moving it about. Now, Kim, just on the subject of spots, you were wondering if there's ever been a leopard that was born without spots. And the closest answer to yes would probably be, oh, you're so strong. Look at that. Feet all spread out, claws right out. Sorry, Kim. I'll be back with you in a moment, but I'm just watching her reposition. It really is fascinating how incredibly powerful they are, even at 5 months of age. That carcass probably weighs what she does, and she's just been hoisting it around. So Kim, a leopard that is melanistic, in other words, has a very high concentration of melanin, is born black. However, most of them you can sort of see the spots coming through underneath the blackness of the coat. So it's not really born without spots, but they do have very, very high concentrations of melanin. So yes, in that sense you would get a leopard born without spots. And that's probably the only case. You get leucistic leopards, or strawberry-coloured leopards, but they do have spots. They're just a little bit lighter in colour than the others. Oh, And while we've been busy watching his sister, George has decided to roll over and give us George. Now I'm using James's names, which is a dangerous habit to fall into, because when they do get their official names, it's going to be a very difficult one to break. But the sleeping prince has rolled over to give us a perfect view of his spotted white belly that looks as though he's swallowed quite possibly some sort of small ball. He is so round. And I'm not sure there is a leopard cub in the world that looks more contented than he does at this point. Yes, have a jolly good sleep, little one. You've got so much growing to do still. It's hard to believe these are the same little cubs that, as soon as they saw the vehicle coming, would dash away, and only when their mom called them out would they come slinking out of the grass to come and join her. Now he doesn't look as though he could be, or that he is in any way stressed out by the presence of the vehicle. And it's the sort of the constant ethical guiding in the Sabi Sand, which is why we're so lucky to be here, and why it is so famous for the opportunities to view these animals behaving as they naturally would. Well, it seems as though James is on an antelope roll, and he's found a different but equally fluffy one.
There is a kudu, everybody, and as you came live to us, you saw two zebras running out of frame, and the rest of the kudus are coming down through the woodland over there. That's quite a good return for a day like today. I'm going to sneak forward to a really nice kudu sighting. This is a fairly large bull with them and some lovely cows. Hello, ladies. There, nice to see you on this blustery day. There they go. Now, the social structure, of course, of a kudu, semi-related females, their offspring. And one or two bulls, sometimes sort of in attendance, but usually not with the herd. He's relatively young, that chap. You can see his horns have got 1.5 full twists, which must make him roughly 3 years old. One full twist every 2 years. And they're big, you know, they're tall. They're probably about 5'5" at the shoulder. And two lovely bulls are all roughly about the same age. Maybe those ones slightly older, about 4 years old. And coming, lurking behind them, the zebra. Everything hanging around with non-con specifics. In other words, animals not the same as themselves for security reasons. That impala and the waterbuck, the zebra and the kudu. And I think the zebra probably are two young stallions without a kinship group. So they're a little bit nervous. They don't have a sort of family home of their own, Viam. They must hang around as the pariahs of society for the next little while until they've managed to take themselves some wives. And there they all go down there. I think they're going down to have a drink, perhaps. They're heading towards the dam, or at least towards the thick bush on the fringes of the drainage line that lead to the dam. And can you hear the wind rustling? You can see the leaves swaying from side to side. And look how cleverly coloured they are. And Lucy in South Bend, Indiana, yes, you're correct. You say the wind looks like it's taken the leaves off the trees. It has, certainly. But what I would like you to do the next time you see Jamie Patterson, which will probably be in the next 10 minutes or so, maybe even less than that, if you're really lucky, ask her how this has changed since she went on leave, because I think that there's been a profound change in the 2 weeks since she went away, or it's actually only 10 days, and all the Cambretum trees have suddenly decided that their leaves must go away now, and then the wind is now blowing them off the trees. And I think if you ask her, she'll tell you that there has been a profound change since she was last here. And it happened almost overnight one day that all the Combretum trees suddenly decided that's it, and you could see on the horizon everything went this kind of yellowish, greenish, copperish colour. Righty, on we go. Oh dear, Viam. Look at this great tragedy in front of us. I will have to remove it with my great strength and power. Are you watching? Ah! Are you impressed?
Yes.
Good. Ah, it's good to good to do a bit of exercise, Viam. Keeps you young, you know. Keeps you young. On we go. The zebra and the kudu are coming back this way. It's very odd. Anyway, let us go back to Jamie Patterson. Off quickly, Charlotte's coming down the tree.
Your timing is perfect because look who's making her way down. Oh, oh. Hey, that was pretty graceful. Well done. I've seen leopard cubs this size go tumbling out of trees, but the female cub managed to make that descent look almost like she's mastered the art of tree climbing. She nearly dropped the carcass out of the tree, just by the way. Oh. Oh, that's so sweet. Little bit of affection there between mom and daughter. Quickly clean away all of that dacre that I'm sure she's got everywhere. Krula making sure that her cubs stay clean. Even when they resist. She was lying on the carcass earlier, so Karula doing a fantastic job of sorting her out. Cleaning paws away. No, Mom, I don't want a bath. I'm done now. I want to fight. I want to play fight. Oh, I'm so glad that we've got to see this. I'll just bear with me one second. Taxon is wanting to come and join us. Oh, got you, Mom. Kathy in Tennessee. We're watching this little female bat a mom about and resist her attempts at a bath. An attempt to make them into playtime. You're wondering which becomes independent first, a female or a male. Interestingly enough, it's the female cubs that tend to become independent faster. They just generally show more independence than the male, even if they're a little bit shyer at first. They're usually the ones that start play hunting first. She was trying to move the carcass around earlier, and at around a year and a half, they'll start to move off on their own. Male cubs, on the other hand, actually tend to be mommy's boys, and they stick around for a little bit longer, every now and again moving off on their own and then coming back, and they can stay with their mom right up until 2 years old and even revisit her a couple of times in their initial first steps towards independence. Oh, somebody's getting a really thorough bath from Mom. George could not be... Oh, no, I'm doing it again. I'm in that habit now. James has done a terrible thing. Michelle, you want to know who will give the cubs their official names. Well, at this point, I mean, I'm going to have a habit that is going to be incredibly difficult to break. But the official naming will be done at a rangers meeting where every interested party... Hello, gorgeous. Sorry, Michelle. Yarr, cub pile. George wants to sleep. Charlotte wants to play. Oh, there's Mom's tail. And now Mom is thinking about having a little bit of a late afternoon snack. She's actually not full-bellied at all. Most of that has gone towards the cubs. Oh, Mom's actually getting up to relieve herself. Right, Michelle, sorry, to get back to your question about naming of the cubs. Each of the interested parties, in other words, the lodges that get to see Karula and the cubs, will put forward name suggestions onto a during a meeting, and they will then, as a sort of a democratic unit, the various guides of the various lodges will vote upon the different options. So it's quite a democratic process. It used to be, there's a couple of different traditions, it used to be the longest serving guide, so the guide, whoever's been around for the longest, would get to name them, or else the person who first found them, which in this case, of course, would have been Brent. But the tradition has changed ever so slightly, and it has now become a more democratic process to, I think, make things a little bit more fair for the people who see them every day and refer to them by their names. Now, of course, as you know, leopard cubs only generally, traditionally, get named after their first year, just because the mortality rate is so high. However, during a meeting, we did discuss this, and we think that we're going to push forward naming the cubs a little bit earlier. Where are we off to, everybody? Oh, big cat stretch. There goes George. Probably to shelter in that drainage line away from the wind. Let's go and investigate. She might also be thirsty. Whoopsie. Is there a bit of a jump there, George? Are you going to pounce on your sister? But yes, we are going to try and name them a bit sooner, because otherwise we're all going to start calling them George and Charlotte. And surprise attack from Mum. Oh, wow. We're extraordinarily privileged to be able to witness this. Hey, Karula, you don't look like you've eaten much of that daker at all. Oh, hello. Number two has arrived. Watch out, Karula, there's a cub there. Ah, I believe we have the royal urination occurring. Similar to coronation, but not quite as dignified. Yes, that's yours, Karula. There you go. Just like domestic cats do. Genteel, ever the lady, now covering up the remains of the excretory process, whilst being carefully watched by George, who I think is definitely not going to be taking notes because he's a male leopard. He'll do things a little bit differently. Oh no, we were just digging a hole for the second half. There is a sentence here I never thought I would use, but I think that the Queen is feeling a bit constipated. But there we go. We have relief as George watches on. Sorry, George. He looks relatively unconcerned. He's also got relatively brown eyes. It's fascinating. What you doing, Mum? I want to play. Now I want to play. How many of you at home have got kids that at that point when they're toddlers or grandkids, that you haven't really even got an opportunity to go to the bathroom on their own? Oh, ambush. Oh, Mum proving the superiority of her climbing skills, leaving the cubs far behind and coming to enjoy a little bit of whatever's left of the daker, whatever scraps they have left her with. Yes, have a jolly good sniff. What's the plan now, George? Mom's up the tree. Sister's gone who knows where. Who are you going to follow? Probably the sister. Now, Charlotte in PE, not Charlotte the Leopard Cub, you were wondering, oh, big yawn, showing off those fearsome canines. You were wondering whether it's possible to have leopard cubs sired by two different fathers from the same litter. Interestingly enough, we don't know. And that's why this Panthera scat analysis is going to be so incredibly fascinating when we do actually find out the results. So what we're doing at the moment is we're collecting leopard scat in order for them to do DNA tests on the paternity of the different leopards. Because as you can imagine, it's pretty easy to figure out who mom is. But dad proves to be a little bit more tricky. And I'll explain a bit more in a moment. Go ahead, Tax. Just need to help Tax come and join us. That's affirmative. You're more than welcome. Okay, guys, we're going to reposition before Tax gets here. We are allowed to have two people in the sighting at the age that the cubs are at, so we don't have to leave just yet. So back to Charlotte's question. There's been a lot of speculation because, of course, a leopard female will mate with as many males as she can. There's been a lot of speculation as to whether or not it's possible that cubs of the same litter could be fathered by the same or by different leopards. And as I said, we don't know the answer. It's okay. It's all right, boy. Oh, there's number two. You were very sneaky. Number two is, I think, just out of Dave's line of sight. There's George. He's planning a surprise attack on Sis. Sis remains completely unaware. If you keep going left, Dave, I think you would find her. She might be hidden behind that tree for you. She's behind that fallen tree. There we go. Here's number two. And George definitely thinking about making a sneak attack. Oh, he's changed his mind. I think he might go up and join Mom. I can't wait to hear the results of the paternity tests so that we can find out whether or not leopards do actually father or can actually have this members of the same litter fathered by different males. Be fascinating. Karula's mated with Tingana, Mvula, and Gijima. I don't know if she's ever mated or she's ever been seen mating with Anderson, but that's a distinct possibility. Sneaking off. While we do some repositioning and some juggling here with Texan and his guests, let's go across to James, who has found, amazingly, with all the trees, some bark.
Hello, everybody. We're just trying to find a few little things, like I said to you, because the animals are all hiding in the bushes. You can see I've put my woolly hat on because it's a bit chilly. Now, Viam, can you see the gecko? There was a gecko here, everyone. It came out from underneath this piece of bark. So let me bring this around to you and show you what's going on. I shall replace this. Hopefully it'll stay. But it's a marula tree, obviously, that was pushed over by elephants some time back. And it's still alive, astoundingly. And just look under here. The termites have got underneath the bark and they've eaten away at the wood. And I guess this is... I suppose it's largely their dung, really. They've chewed it up and left it there, and it's now a very fine mist blowing onto Viam. Sorry about that. And I was hoping to find one or two more creatures here, like a spider or two, but I haven't found any. Just the gecko, which is now very cross with me because I rather disturbed him. So let's put this back. Do you think it's going to stay, Viam? Did you bring the gaffer tape? Not necessary. There we go. I'll take the camera off it before it falls off. We've come along the eastern boundary. This is Torchwood over here. And it's as suspected. It's rather quiet. But we're going to keep on our search. Stoic fellows that we are. And we're much relieved, of course, that Karula, Charlotte and Georgie are on site, so we can keep our looking while you enjoy them. Not that you're going to enjoy them again just yet. Must keep you waiting a little bit. You too must come with us to search the wilderness in the wind. I think I got some termite dung in my eye. It's very sore, Vim. Did you get termite dung in your eye?
No, in my hair.
In your hair? Mm. You're lucky you have hair.
I know.
I'd love to say I got termite dung in my hair.
I'll give it all my
hair. No, I don't want your hair. I want my own hair. Now, Jenny, you say, is there any hint of rain around the place? Vim was just saying he thought the horizon looked a bit misty, and therefore maybe there might be a bit of rain, but we both agreed that we didn't think so. No, you know what, Jenny, so seldom does this kind of weather bring us rain. It sometimes brings us a bit of spittle, a couple of drops here and there, but real rain, real storms, normally come swirling in from the north. Or they come in round from there and sort of northeast, and they come over the top here. This is a front, and these fronts very seldom bring any kind of rain. They just bring fairly foul weather. And there is no other way to describe the weather we're experiencing now. It is foul. We'll just go to the end of the road here, and then we'll turn west. I'm going to then go up to Mulwati Drainage or somewhere around there and see if that lion hasn't taken shelter somewhere around there. Then why are you looking at me suspiciously?
The mic's doing weird stuff.
My mic's doing weird stuff.
Yeah.
Aaron, hi, in New Zealand. You say, is there any reason we don't see pied crows here? Aaron, we do see pied crows here every so often. In fact, the last time I saw them was about a week ago. What is the matter? VM says, my mic's doing strange things. I apologize if my sound is breaking up at all. It's fine on Kirsten's side, that's good. VM, stop looking at me like that. Aaron, we do get them every so often. Then they are an indigenous species, but they're not common here at all. And I don't really know why that should be the case. I guess they're just outcompeted, perhaps, by birds like vultures and other birds of prey, because they do share a very similar diet, but they're obviously not competing for them. And they also do rather better than vultures and other birds of prey in urban situations. And so normally when we see pied crows, they're in sort of urban situations. Right, we have very successfully driven the length of cheetah cut line without finding one mammal. Well done to us. Let's go back to the leopards with Jamie.
And we are still with our leopard, even if James hasn't had any success with the mammal life on cheetah cut line. The queen is enjoying the Dacre kill and giving her cubs a demonstration as to what they'll be able to do with their teeth one day as she crunches her way through the bits of bone that they had to nibble around. And the leopard-like Karula is actually capable of consuming most of the bones of a Dacre kill, although she'll probably leave the leg bones, but she'll eat most of the ribs. I've seen her finish an entire steenbok before, leaving only a little bit of the lower jaw behind. She ate everything, hooves and all. So there's a common sort of misconception that lions and leopards, unlike hyenas, don't eat bones. They do eat bones. They just tend to go for the slightly smaller ones. The two little cubs, for now, have moved off. But I think they will be coming back up in a moment. Deb in Ohio, you were wondering about how old the cubs will be before they go their separate ways and whether or not they will know each other when they meet up again. It's always an interesting question. Yes, just to answer the second one first, yes, they do seem to know each other, leopard siblings. That being said, that doesn't mean that their greeting will be joyous. So Even between mother and daughter, or father and son, leopards are by nature solitary and territorial, which means that they tend not to be very tolerant of another leopard of the same sex. Different sexes, so a male and a female meeting up might be a little bit more peaceful, a lot less growling, perhaps less posturing over the territory. And it's one of the big things about male and female leopard cubs is that the females tend to stick around close to home. The males, when they reach full adulthood, will actually move quite a bit further away. And when they separate, will depend upon, as I said earlier, the female cubs usually reach independence first, so she most likely, Karula's female cub, will be the first to go. She'll move off at around a year and a half, maybe a little bit older. So that will be the time in which the leopard cubs separate from each other. Now I am whispering just because there is another vehicle here in the sighting. I don't want to ruin the sighting for them. We definitely don't want to be scaring the cubs in any way. Oh, it's time to focus on the head now. And the nose. Crunching away. And you'll see she licks the carcass first before she bites into it and strips away a little bit of the hair. Oh, goodness. Quite a macabre sight. You can see her using the carnassial shear, the molars at the back of her mouth, to crunch through. Eat the nose and the jawbone. And she's finding it tough work. Hard going at the moment. But then she's not ravenous, so she's quite happy to take her time. Whoopsie. Oh dear. Oh well, this bit'll do. If I can't eat the head, I'll munch on the hip. She's put this carcass up nice and high, and as with all leopard kills that have been pulled into trees, they do show a preference for trees with lots of leaves to help hide the carcass. And that's not just to hide it away from lions and hyenas, it's also to try and keep it away from the prying eyes, very, very sharp eyes, of the birds of prey. And once a tawny eagle descends, what they will do, a tawny eagle or a battalier or one of the other scavenging raptors, they can actually knock the kill onto the ground and then make it easy for something like a hyena to come through and carry it off. So they try and hide them away as carefully as possible. Oops, that dake is about to fall out of the tree. Yeah, it's about to go, Karula. It's looking decidedly stretched. The bottom of it's dangling. And she's going to have to try and lift it back out. Guys, we're going to have to go relatively soon, as you can imagine. There are several vehicles wanting to come through. I just want to chat to Tex and guys. Hold on 1 second. I'll pull out. Tax, I'll pull out when Warren comes. It's fine if you guys want to wait. Yeah. It's perfect. The track's right up there. The vehicle tracks. Oh, there's a cub. Sorry, just spotted that. It was at the bottom on the right-hand side of the tree. And I think they've found themselves a nice little... There you go. There's movement there. Oh, no. Did you see that? Well done, everybody. Those of you watching with sharp eyes. That's at least where one of the cubs is. hiding away. Such a marvelous time spent. And guys, as I said, there are lots and lots of people that are wanting to come and see these leopard cubs, and obviously we don't want more than two vehicles here with them. We don't want to frighten them or for them to feel threatened in any way. At the moment they're absolutely happy, but to throw another vehicle into the mix is definitely not what we want to do. As soon as one of the responding vehicles decides to approach or gets a little bit closer, then we will move on. They're fine for now though. We'll enjoy as much time as we can with them while we have them. I'm glad she's managed to snatch some food. Will the cubs eat all of it? Well, we spoke before about the possibility of, or the amazing ability of James to find some bark. He's now accomplished the almost impossible in the Sabi Sands, and that is to find a rock. Let's go and find out what he's up to.
Are we live? Hello, everybody. Here I am lying in the road, as one does on a blustery day. And the reason I'm lying in the road is because, well, my back's a little stiff and sore, but mainly because I was investigating this fairly large piece of mud. Now, what it is and why it's here is a source of some mystery to us. It's a piece of termite mound, and how it got there, I suspect, is evidenced by the, or is probably a result of, what I can hear through there, elephants going, oh. And elephants like to play with these things. They pick up rocks and they put them in the road, and they pick them up with their trunks and move them around and then leave them about the place. But where it's come from, I couldn't tell you. Can you see it's very clearly a termite mound, and it's very clearly termites have been living in it, and roots have grown into it. So it's an old piece of termite mound, but I can't see where it's come from. Yes, I can. It's come from here. It's come from underneath this tree. So the termites have eaten away the wood, the dead wood of this tree. They've built that mound. It's probably not one of those big fungus-growing termite mounds. And an elephant has come, kicked this away, eaten a bit of the roots, and picked it up just kind of because it's fun to play with, and their tracks are all over here, and dropped it here on the road. Very selfishly, I'd ask them to next put them away. Shall we move this again, Vim? Put it back in its hole. It's quite heavy, Vim. There we are. It weighed roughly, I don't know, probably weighed about 15 kilograms, 40 pounds or so. Oh, it's exhausting work out here. We've also managed to find you, everybody, believe it or not, and VM doesn't even know what I'm going to say, a waterbuck. It's just over here, and it's been staring at me in utter incredulity as I picked up that piece of mound. Say when, VM.
Not now.
More. Yeah, there we are. Oh, look, VM, look ahead of us. There seems to be something coming down the road. Now, I do not want to get in their way. This is a large elephant cow with a very small baby. Now, they've got plenty of space to go around us, so I'm just going to wait here. This is a bull. He is absolutely massive. He's not fully grown, but he's still fairly substantial. In fact, he's very substantial indeed. Was it you who put that thing in the road? Not. Okay, fair enough. I think I'll believe you. Now, I'm making light of the situation, but he is very large. But because he's not, he's probably about 20 years old. I don't think he poses too much of a threat to us, and I haven't blocked their way entirely. They could move around us. This is fascinating. This is a bull. I can't see an adult cow with them. There's a young cow there with a very small baby. You see there? And she's lactating. That's definitely her baby. Look at him protecting them. You see him protecting them there? He's just got himself between them and us. And the little one, look at the tiny little thing. This is really fascinating, everyone. And he's put himself between her and us. It's another cow. No, that's a young bull. It's a young bull. And it's like he's looking after them. Good on you, fellow. That was absolutely sensational. Isn't that amazing? All right, let's quickly go back to Karula for one last look.
We've still got a little while to go, and unfortunately, sorry guys, I've just got to get on the Game Drive channel as you came across to us. Never mind, there's a conversation going on. So we've got one last look at Karula. The cubs are hiding below in the drainage line. And her carcass is in half with one very thin strip of skin. And it looks as though it's about to fall on top of where her cubs are hiding. She's just managing to cling onto it and keep it on, but it's about to go down. Oh, lifting it up a bit. Yes, girl, you better change position or that's going to go flying. Henry, go ahead. Henry, I think Orbs has got standby after Andrew, but you can take it after him. Aubrey? No problem. We're going to move out as soon as Andrew comes through. Hi guys. Cubs are down there. Here we go. Munching away. As you can imagine, everybody wants an opportunity to have a feed on these dacre carcasses. Now we are very, very close now to Treehouse Dam, which seems to be one of Karula's preferred spots. And Joyce, you were wondering, what is the closest waterhole to where Karula is now? The treehouse is probably about 50 or so yards away from where we're sitting. It doesn't have much in the way of water in it, but the interesting thing about Treehouse Dam, because it is on a seep line, it actually has water just below the surface, and most of the time the elephants have dug holes that the leopards can go and drink from. So Treehouse is the closest. Failing that, if she doesn't find any water there or doesn't have any luck there, then she will probably go across to the Juma Pan, which is about a mile away from where we are now, maybe just a little bit less. She's got plenty of water around her still. So for those of you, once we leave Karula and her cubs, for those of you who keep track of the Juma Dam camera, perhaps tuning in after the sunset safari would not be a bad idea, because there's always a chance that a Karula and her little ones might pop through to have a drink. I don't think she's going to be here tomorrow. I think that dacre kill is pretty much done, and she's probably going to move her cubs off at some point during the night. She's been incredibly successful over the last few days. And having the cubs with her now, not almost permanently, but definitely having them around a lot, still hasn't seemed to have hampered her hunting ability. trying to see if the cubs are going to pop their heads up, but I think they've gone to sleep with very, very full bellies on the other side of the drainage line, or in the drainage line itself, giving Mom a bit of peace to enjoy whatever's left. Oh, that didn't look like a particularly appetizing bit that she's crunching away on. Okay, guys, it comes time for us to move off. We're going to let Andrew come into the sighting, so we'll bid the great queen a farewell for now. We've spent... Oh, yuck. She obviously didn't want that bone shard. We've spent a marvellous time with her and the two cubs, and it's time for us to give other people a chance. I'm whispering away into my microphone so as not to make too much noise. We're going to send you back across to James while we pull out of the sighting, and we'll see you in a little bit.
There's a batelier there, everybody. That's what VM was filming. Yeah, it would have been about 2 pixels on your screen. Can you still see it there, VM? No. Well, there it is. Well done, VM. He's got it. That is a chimungue, or batelier, that VM is now sick of filming. But over there, we've got a couple of starling species. One starling and one drongo. Hello, drongo. Very nice. Now, that, I think, was one of the most remarkable elephant sightings I've had for a little while. A very strangely young herd with a bull looking after them, and he was very, very clearly looking after them. He came up, he was leading them, he stopped in front of us, he got between us and them, and they walked around him. And that young cow with the calf, probably about 11 years old, 11 or 12, so, you know, probably, in fact, almost certainly her first calf. And he had sort of taken care of them. I don't know why they've been split from their, what would logically be the matriarchal herd, or where they've come from. I don't know. I think it's fascinating. Now, I've just spotted something else here that well, it might not blow your mind, but it'll be sort of interesting. There, you see that bit of sort of termite mound there? That's from a termite mound exactly the same as the one that the elephants pulled out and dropped on the road there. So that's quite interesting. They're under quite a few of these trees, those different termite mounds. And that is not what we'd call the mound-growing or the mound-building termite, the fungus termite, Macrotermes natalensis. Hello, Fox Hat. Very nice question. We were looking at the termite mound, and we were looking at the dung inside the dry wood termites had left inside the... inside that wood earlier, and you want to know if termite dung is fertile. I would say most certainly. If you look at termite mounds, they are filled with termite dung, obviously. It's also very well aerated soil, but the grass and trees that grow on termite mounds are in high demand, especially during dry times. So yes, almost certainly I'd say the termite dung is very, very fertile. Termites are one of the very few creatures, of course, that are, they're not one of the few creatures, but they are able to digest cellulose and lignin, which are the structural components of plants, and they do that either by actually having cellulase, which are the enzymes that digest those things, or they grow the fungus gardens. And those fungus gardens, which then basically the mycelia of those fungus plants, or not fungus plants, of the fungi, they digest the plant material, and then the termites eat the fungus. And that must make for a tremendously fertile kind of organic rich soil in the mound and underneath it. And you combine that with the fact that they normally reach the water table, they're very well aerated, and you have an area conducive to much plant growth. Nice question. We're now heading down the sort of middle of the reserve, middle south, and heading for the Mulwati drainage line, and we'll go and see if we can't spot that lion that we found this morning. I think he will be in some very, very thick bush at this stage, though. And this wind is very strong and unremitting. Liam, this is where you and I first saw Karula. Do you remember that fond day, those halcyon days so many years ago?
Yep.
So many years ago being roughly 12 months ago.
The old memories.
Oh, the good memories, Liam, yes. Perhaps a buffalo or two around here. Aileen, you say am I not glad that I wasn't lying on the road when the elephants came along? Aileen, I'm very glad I wasn't lying on the road when the elephants came along, although I would have been very interested to see what they would have done. And I suspect what they would have done was stop, be slightly alarmed, and then moved off. I don't think that they would have come towards me. I don't know that for sure. And I wouldn't like to try it out. What have you spotted, Liam? It was the tree, yes. Liam is just sharing a memory, everybody. That was the tree in which Karula was. So, and isn't now. We know exactly where Karula is. She ate a bushbuck there. Aileen, it's quite interesting. I think that bull would have come up. I don't think he would have come near me. I think he would have seen me there. He may have trumpeted. He may have shaken his head. If I'd lain completely still, I think he would have walked around with the herd in almost the same way that he did with the vehicle. They're not inherently nasty, vicious creatures who, would take lightly to killing a person. Yes, they do kill people from time to time, but that's normally when they're feeling extremely threatened. And a human being lying on the road like that, it wouldn't be a threat to them. And certainly you hear stories of people sleeping under trees, passed out, and waking up with elephants sort of smelling them. Now, very nice question from Pamela there. That elephant bull warned us. So he shook his head at us as if to say, I'm not that comfortable with you here. And you say, do I think I could have, if I had backed up, would he have remained calm? Yes, I do think he would have remained calm if I backed up. If I'd started the engine, I think he probably would have got a fright. I just didn't feel any sense of threat from him. Now, as we drove away, I thought to myself, am I not being rather complacent about this? Am I not being guilty of getting the Sabi Sand complacency syndrome? I don't think I was. I'm going to give myself the benefit of the doubt there, because he approached us. We were parked on the road. We didn't drive up to them. We stopped there. They came towards us. And normally what that would mean is that unless he was being overtly aggressive, which he most certainly wasn't, they were coming down the road. They stopped. They decided what we were, and they moved around the side. And that's generally what they will do. He also wasn't a great big bull of, say, 40 years old in must. If he had been, and he'd come walking down the road, like that big hole in the ear elephant that we'd had, I'd have turned around quickly and just driven off and increased the space between us. But he didn't in any way indicate a threat. He shook his head as if to say, don't come any closer. He got himself between us and the herd. We sat nice and quietly. We didn't make a noise. And so he walked around us. That's my... Keep constantly asking yourself about these things. And because you don't want to become overconcerned with elephants, it's extremely dangerous to do that. Because elephants can sometimes be very upset with us. You might lose signal here. So let's go across to Jamie and get an update from her.
Oh, we're just pottering about now. Dave and I can't really wipe the smiles off our faces, because an afternoon doesn't really get better than that. Even if the weather is a little bit miserable, another glorious afternoon in the winter African bush. The intrepid Wild Earth team will go out no matter the weather, unless it's raining really hard, in which case we won't go out. But other than that, wind and cold. Sorry, hold on 1 second. I think I just got a very strange game drive comm there. Last station, sorry, please go again. Okay, copy. Sorry. I got a little bit confused there. I heard my name on the game drive channel.
Alright, so we're going to bumble about, ducking the wind. And welcome to Ronan, who is one of our newer viewers. And Ronan would like to know, on a cold day like today, does it affect the animals' appearances? It does, to an extent. So let's take physical appearance first. A lot of them are hiding away, first of all. A lot of them are lying down, second, just to try and shelter away from the wind a little bit. A lot of them are more puffed up. So just like human beings, when we get goosebumps when we're cold, the animals do the same thing in order to trap warmth underneath their fur, which is why impala look a little bit of a darker red color. The different antelope species appear a bit more fluffy, if we could use that term to describe it. But the most impact, sorry, there's something in my eye. I think it's just a hair. We'll be okay. Otherwise, I know I've got Dave there to save me. Yeah, I think I'm okay. I've even spotted the elephant that is standing in the middle of an open area, which is quite the achievement. The big thing that the weather has an effect on is the animal's behavior. So what it does is it just makes them a little bit more nervous. It interferes with their hearing, it interferes with their sense of smell. They hear rustles all the time and it makes them nervous. As you can imagine, if you're even the elephants actually tend to get a little bit uncomfortable. Let's see if we stop here, see what this gentleman is feeling. So you'll find that with most of us, whenever we approach an animal on a windy day, we're very, very careful. We're also very careful when we go walking, we go tracking, just to make sure that we don't scare them in any way. At this point, this young bull looks more than happy to have us near him. In fact, he hasn't even glanced in our direction. Young elephant bull. The reason I say that is just judging by his size, because of course tusk length is not an indication of an elephant's age. Some have short tusks, some have long tusks. It's just genetics. But he looks relatively small, if one could call an elephant that. In fact, he's so young, I would say that he's only probably just recently left the safety of his herd. I've always said is must be a very confusing time for a young male elephant that's always enjoyed the safety of a breeding herd growing up. He seems perfectly content though. He's got the company of the fork-tailed drongos, the little blackbirds that keep fluttering about, catching any insects that he stirs up, as he attempts to make the most of the meager offerings that quarantine has to give. This is the clearing that we're on. We're on quarantine clearings. And due to the drought and the fact that it's the dry season, there's hardly anything left for them to eat. Now, Fiona, in the UK, you've been studying our elephant's body language. And you were wondering why elephants lift up their front feet, or lift up a front foot and sort of rock it from front to back, sort of in an almost restless fashion. Now, that can be a couple of things. Probably the best description for that motion, if we have to, bearing in mind that you can't read it in isolation, you have to watch what the rest of the elephant's doing as well. But probably the best description for that action alone is indecision. The elephant's sort of trying to decide where he's going to go next or what he's going to do next. It can be a sign of agitation. So if their tail has gone stiff, if their ears and their trunk, if they've gone very still but they're rocking their foot backwards and forwards and looking at you out of the corner of their eye, it might mean that you've agitated them slightly. In a resting position like this, it's just an elephant being an elephant, kind of like where you stand, you've been standing for a long time and you shift your weight onto one hip and bend one knee. That's sort of what an elephant does. What he's doing there though is different. So he's actually using his feet, that motion there, when it's touching the ground in the way that he's doing, that's because he's uprooting the grass. So he's using his foot in conjunction with his trunk to help him get to the growth points and the sort of the most nutritional parts of the grass. And as you can imagine, not very, but the brown inflorescences and stems that are still above the surface of the ground are not very nutritional, that's not a word, Nutritious, that is a word. There we go, got there eventually. So he's just digging up. You can see how windy it is. Every time he kicks the sand, there's just billows of dust. Hey boy. Not very pleasant weather for you guys either. You can imagine what it's like. You know what it's when you sort of have a repetitive noise of maybe somebody's doing construction work on a house next door, or drilling, or using an angle grinder, whatever it may be. You know how that noise, a repeated noise after a while, starts to irritate you. Now imagine if your hearing is super sensitive, as an elephant's is, or most of the animals out here, far better than ours. Now imagine you've got to block out that constant gusting of wind and rustling of leaves. I know James talked about it earlier, about how everything's dried up, the leaves are all falling off the trees. Imagine how distracting that must be. That constant, almost overstimulation of your hearing. What he's doing now is he's looking for the grass at the base of trees or underneath fallen or dead logs, because that tends to be where the most nutrition lies. It's a bit more sheltered than the grass in the open areas. Oh, there was nearly, I don't know, those of you with keen eyes might have seen the near collision between the hornbill and the drongo that nearly occurred there. They almost flew into each other. Not terribly easy fluttering about in this kind of wind when you're only a couple of grams in weight. The starling around there as well, picking at whatever they can find. And behind him, sort of the elephant in the room, so to speak, is the final control tower. So that is our signal being broadcast at the back there. That's the Voyatella repeater, just so that you know, and we address that. It almost looks like a tree, actually. It's quite well hidden. But right above the elephant's back, the tower is peeking out. And that is what gives us our ability to broadcast our live safaris. Phenomenal. A warm welcome to HK, who is one of our newer viewers, and would like to know why elephants are so frightened of humans. There's a couple of different things to say there. For the most part, they aren't, especially the elephants, or at least the elephants in this area. So they've been protected for many, many years. The Kruger's just celebrated its 90th birthday, which is longer than the lifespan of an elephant. The Sabi Sands has been around even longer than that. I'm just going to adjust things here because my scarf is playing havoc with the sound. My apologies. I know I should put it in my beanie, but it's not very comfortable. So the elephants here are not scared of people to an extent. At least they're not scared of people in safari vehicles. They've learned that we are of no threat to them. Sometimes they do get uncomfortable and they give us the signs and we move away. Sometimes they might be in a really bad mood, and that's where things change, and it's very, very important that we're watching what they're doing. That being said, elephants have had thousands and thousands of years of, as have all of the animals here, of seeing the bipedal human form as the apex predator. Human beings have been hunting elephants for as long as there have been human beings. This no longer occurs, thank goodness, where we are, but in other areas poaching does happen. Other areas further in Africa, Mozambique, for example, further north, and there the elephants are terrified of people. And even aggression from an elephant, and I use the term aggression with a little bit of, with more concern than anything else, even aggression from elephants comes from fear more than it does from an actual angry side of things. That being said, elephants are bright, and sometimes they are just cross. Hello, Christy, who is in Virginia Beach and with her four-year-old daughter. We're at a teacher conference in Virginia Beach. Now, Lauren, who is 4 years old. Hello, Lauren. Welcome on safari. I hope you're enjoying this elephant. Now, you want to know, do I know how old this elephant is? Do I know its name? And how much does it weigh? So Lauren, I don't know this elephant's name. We haven't named all of our elephants just because we're so lucky we've got so many that we couldn't possibly keep track of all of them. But it is possible to identify different individuals. Let's have a look at his ear. Look really closely. See that little cut? That little hole on the edge of his ear? That will stay like that forever. There we go. Thank you, Dave. So we'll always be able to identify this elephant. And Lauren, if you want, you are more than welcome to give your elephant his name. I'm happy to hear what you would like to call it. Now, in terms of age, I said it's a young boy. It is a boy because he's all alone. The girls always stay with other elephants, but this boy is all on his own. If I had to guess, Lauren, I think he's maybe around his late teen years. Might be a little bit older, but I think he's a teenager. He's a teenage elephant. Maybe if we say 16, 17, isn't he beautiful? Now, at 16 or 17 years old, a teenage male elephant weighs, Lauren, probably weighs about 4 tons, which is close to about 8,500 pounds. So this elephant bull weighs more than me, it weighs more than Dave, me, and the car all put together. That's how heavy our boy is. And Lauren, it's up to you. You are welcome to name this elephant. He's having a marvelous time here. Dust blowing everywhere. Shame. And the animals do, at this point, have to scrape out something of a meager living. And I'm quite surprised to find an elephant here on quarantine trying to get to the root systems. They've been focusing mainly on the trees, but there might be a few sort of smaller plant species that are there that he's getting to, helping to keep quarantine a clearing. Look at how he's using his trunk to sniff and then grab whatever he kicks up. So he sniffs about with his trunk and there he kicks to uproot the plant and then he grabs it and then into his mouth it goes. Sniffing away, looking for his next meal. And then, whenever he pulls up a piece of grass, he dusts it off, because elephants, much like people, don't really like dirt on their food. I think we're going to leave our Ellie Bull to his late evening supper and go and see what else we can find. While we do that, let's find out where in the world James Hendry is.
I'm driving down the Philemon's cut line. The aerial's just hanging at a jaunty angle there. Is it all right?
Yes.
Okay, good. This is fine. And we are heading west down towards the big brown ivory tree here. And we're doing that because Viam has decided that this is where we are likely to find a male leopard. Not so, Viam.
Correct.
Why have you decided this? Something whisper in your ear?
Sort of.
Right, sort of, he says. Something whispered in his ear. I didn't have a better idea, so I thought we'd do the same. We did drive up the Mulwati drainage line for a while, see if we could pick up tracks of that lion. We did not. But there is a lion calling on Biffle's Hook. Obviously, we can't go there. But it does mean that the lion around where we were today on Twin Dams Road might respond by calling back. So I think we'll sort of ease our way back around that way. Jamie's in that area, so she might hear him if he calls back. Here's the big brown ivory tree.
There's an elephant.
Is there an elephant?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Kevin, very nice question. Two answers to it. Let's just get into a position where we can view the elephant here. Nice elephant bull, young one. Well, at least the elephants have come out to show themselves to us. Actually, haven't done too badly, given the state of the weather. He's a bit nervous, though. He's moving off. This is, of course, a favourite old haunt of Sandile and Shadows. I'm hoping it'll be a favourite haunt of hers and Zara's fairly soon, too. Now, Kevin, you say, what is the most terrifying sound out here in the bush? For me, it's the sound of a screaming elephant if it's really upset and it's close by. Even though it's normally young ones that make it, it's a kind of primordial sound, and it's no wonder that they use the sounds of screaming elephants for those Jurassic Park films. That's what those dinosaur sounds are, speeded up and slowed down elephant calls, which is quite interesting. The second, of course, most terrifying sound out here, in fact, it's probably the most terrifying sound, is the sound of a lion growling at you when you're walking on foot. That is a very unpleasant thing to hear, because it means that the lion has been watching you, waiting for you, and you have got too close and not seen it, and then it starts to growl. But a lion's growl is not like the growl of a pit bull or an Alsatian or something like that. It is deep, it is loud, and if you've never heard a lion growl before in your life, I promise you now, your body and your something in the genetics of your evolutionary past will respond immediately. You hear a lion growl, you will go cold. It is a terrifying sound. And you also often can't see where it's coming from, so then you start looking like this, knowing that you can't go backwards because you don't know what's behind you. Yeah, no, it's not a pleasant thing. There are lots of elephants here. Well, 2, 3, 4. Hello, Gracie, aged 8. You say, was that the daddy elephant of that little baby elephant that we saw earlier? I don't know, Gracie. He looked very young to me, but it's possible. And you say, I think he was happy to be with them? I'm sure he was very happy to be with them, Gracie, because he wouldn't have been there otherwise. And I think he was looking after them. And we know that. I mean, you've been watching us for a long time now. You know that that's not normal for daddy elephants. You know that they normally don't hang around. Let me just move a little bit forward here. But he was obviously a little bit different. And I don't think he wanted me to be part of the family. No, Gracie, I think what he was saying to me was, I don't mind you watching us, but I don't think you should come any closer. Look at this young bull here. This young bull is probably about, I'd say he's about 16 or 17 years old. And he's, he's quite a lot shorter than the fellow we saw earlier. But he's not... That fellow we saw earlier wasn't very filled out. Nevin, nice question from you about poaching. You say, do I think that the hunting or that the poaching throughout the years here has had an effect on the tusks and body size? Now, what Nevin's alluding to, everybody, is that, of course, hunters and poachers will go for animals with the biggest tusks, and therefore their genetics get bred out of a population. Nevin, I don't think the poaching's had a huge amount to do with it. I have no doubt that the settlers who came in here and hunted with their guns in the 19th century, I think they are by far more responsible for the reduction in tusk size than any poacher has ever been. So yes, I would say it absolutely has made a difference. I don't think it's been the poachers so much. I think it's been far more those who would describe themselves as sort of ethical hunters who have destroyed the genetics of those great big tuskers in this area. You know, when the Kruger Park was proclaimed in 1926, there was something silly like 10 or 12 elephants left in the area. Can you believe that? All of them shot out. Not by local people, but by hunters selling the ivory into the European markets. He's a lovely bull, this fellow. Now, I said he was a bit shorter than the other one. He is, but he's not short by any stretch. I guess I would reach up to his elbow there, or just his armpit. I get up to his armpit. I'd love to go and stand next to him, I must say. Hello, Eva. This kind of subject is recurring, and it's a good one. It's a nice one to discuss, especially during the drought times. You say, if an animal is starving, would we consider taking it in and feeding it? No, Eva, is the short answer to that question. We try and leave things to be as natural as possible out here. It's not always possible, but in general, no, we wouldn't. There might be, there are some who would put out salt licks, which are sort of large blocks of mineral-rich substance in a sort of almost like an artificial stone. They might put that, a few of those around the place for the animals to come and get a little bit of nutrient from, but there would be no taking in of the animals here. Remember, even the animals out here are completely wild, and although they are habituated to having us around them, they're habituated to vehicles, they are completely wild. So we couldn't go up to that elephant and feed him a bag of oranges if he was in a bit of distress. That just wouldn't be possible. You know, they'd either run away or do us some damage. The wind is really starting to howl now. Let's move away from that chap and just go down the road here. And see the others. They've gone to the south of where we're allowed to go. I was rather hoping we might spot Shadow. We saw her tracks going up and down this road this morning. There's another young bull. How's it going?
How are you?
Good, fine. Where are you off to?
Sticks and youngsters.
Enjoy. Ellie, sorry, that was one of the guides from Elephant Plains, whose name I can never remember. Ellie, you say, what is the most destructive animal out here? Well, unquestionably, that's the human being is the most destructive animal out here. But if you watch this, you'll get the second most right now. Ah, he's decided against pushing it over. He knows you're watching him, Ellie. Ellie, I think it's a term that we should be careful of using, destructive. Elephants are, at face value, destructive. They've pushed over these trees. The tree you're looking at there has been pushed over by elephants. But it's now a whole ecosystem for other creatures. And you can see that the trees have evolved to cope with it because they're still growing. It's not dead. The tree is alive. And all over here, the trees have been pushed over by elephants. And they survive. And the other creatures of this area have evolved to fill the niches that are provided by the elephants when they push the trees over. So yes, it might look like they're being destructive, but they're not so much. They're being much more a keystone species of the area, which means that they have helped mold the ecosystem into what it is. Are they destructive? That is the most bizarre elephant noise I've ever heard. You've got a cold. He hasn't learned to play his trumpet yet. We'll just let him walk quietly away. So, you know, I have no doubt there are landowners around here and many others discussing the fact that the elephants during the drought time are destroying the big trees and what are we going to do about it. They've been doing it for millennia and the ecosystem has evolved because of them, not in spite of them. And so, yeah. They look destructive, but they're not nearly as destructive as we are, for example. This road has far more ecological effect on the area than an elephant does walking through the area. Righty, on we go. Here comes Sean from Arethusa. Good afternoon.
Your white thingy.
How are you?
Well, thank you. How are you?
Good, like full of joy. Yes, I've got a blankie on my leggies. Yes, I've got very cold leggies. It's because that they are very thin, like a plover's.
Preaching to the choir, so.
Ah, yes, you also have no blankie on your leggies. Where are you off to?
I'm a tough ranger.
Yes, you are. You're a very tough ranger. Okay. Enjoy that way.
Stay alive,
we're going this way. Bye-bye, everyone. That's Sean from Arethusa. And with his guests. And they're going that way. The chap from Elephant Plains is going to see the Styx lionesses and their cubs. They are on Chitwa Chitwa, which is unfortunately not somewhere where we can go. Otherwise, we'd be driving at a great speed, I assure you. All right, let's go back across to Jamie and get an update from her.
you've arrived at the perfect time. It gives you a nice indication of just how nervous the poor animals are. The kudu disappearing off as soon as we spotted them and stopped to have a look at them. That was a young male that ducked off there. Let's see if we can't get another view of some of the other females that are hanging about. Oh, hold on a second. Things have just changed. Just have a look at the kudu for one moment, if you can. If Dave can manage to find them again. Sorry, Dave. I just want to get that update. Warren, sorry. Confirm what was on Impala Road? What was that? Okay, copy that. Awesome. I'd like to respond. Copy that. Thanks very much, Warren. Hey! Plans have changed. We were going to Sydney's Dam. We're not going to Sydney's Dam anymore. We're going to Impala Road. Why are we going to Impala Road, you ask? Well, you'll just have to wait and find out. Because I'm not going to tell you. Not even Dave knows. Nobody knows. Only I know. And Warren, who found them. And Henry, who's there. Whee! Ooh! Now, as we race along, with the wind blowing my hair, my hat is about to blow off. Now, James was incredibly rude about my hat. He said it was utterly ridiculous, which I feel is rude because it's actually not my hat, it's Kirsty's hat that she very kindly lent me. And I feel as though the hat shall stay, for it keeps my head very warm and it doesn't fall off my head. Thank you, Dave. Dave likes the hat. And it also has the added benefit of the fact that there's always the possibility a bird will swoop down and take it off my head whilst we're live, which I feel as though might skyrocket SafariLIVE into fame. Never mind. The afternoon is full of surprises and James has another one for you.
Leopard! It's Shadow. Is it? Yes. I think it is. Unfortunately, she's on Hoffman, so we can't go in there. I think she's hunting. What is she hunting for? Oh, man, we were just slightly too late. Let me go back a bit. Maybe we'll get another view. I'm not sure what Jamie's taking you to see. Oh, she's gone. There she goes. Isn't that lovely? Just enjoy, everybody. That's Karula's daughter, 9 years old. She's got a little cub around here somewhere. Well, that was marvellous. We're not allowed to go in there, unfortunately. Oh, well, we're going to continue round towards Arethusa. We had her tracks and the cub's tracks going up and down here this morning, so I'm sure the cub is in there somewhere. Anyway, on we go. All I heard from behind me was, there's a leopard on the road. So I thought he was joking. I thought VM was, but he wasn't. There was a leopard on the road. Could you find another one? Thanks. The chances of that happening, I mean, they're just so remote. To come along here at the right time, we had not met Sean and not met the chap from Elephant Plains, perhaps the timing would have been different and we wouldn't have seen it. Anyway, we'll wait and see what Jamie surprises. I'm rather intrigued myself. We're going to go on to Arethusa and see what we can see. And Jamie won't even tell Kirsten, so it's a great mystery. I'm going to... What do you think it is, VM?
What?
I didn't think I'd missed anything on the radio. Oh, that's a nice thing to see too. Let me get off the road here. Yeah? Not sure what this is. I think it's a staff transport car. Oh, the wind is blowing. NH native, you want to know if I've ever been involved in wildlife projects and research around here? I have in some small projects. I've been far more involved in research with local people and how they relate to these national parks. But I've done a few research projects on wildlife here. And I mean, in terms of big research projects, we're all part of something that Panthera does. They're an NGO that looks after leopards and lions and other big cats, and we contribute to their research by explaining where sightings are, and we collect for them and all sorts of different samples. So in that way we are involved. The Sabi Sand, not a hotbed of research at the moment, but the Kruger area, or the Kruger, an entire scientific services division, and they do a huge amount of research into the wildlife of these areas. We're just coming to the southern end of Arethusa now, and we'll turn then to the west. With any luck, we'll find another leopard.
Well, there we go. Surprise! Slightly sooner than expected because James lost his signal, but luckily our timing was perfect, and apparently Saturday is indeed Cataday today. I just cringed a little bit as I said that. Oh my goodness. But isn't this a lovely surprise? I wonder how long these ladies have been here. There's actually two lionesses here. There's the female that's feeding off the buffalo, and then there's one lying with one very full belly. Now, I'm a little bit embarrassed to tell you, they are right next to a road, right next to Impala Road. I don't think James and myself have driven this road today, so at least we're excused. We didn't miss them. We just had absolutely no idea they were here. My initial guess is that we're looking at the Nkuhuma females. I would say that's almost 100% likely, but you never know. Lion territories are fluid. So despite the fact that we're right smack bang in the sort of home range of the Nkuhumas, might be other lionesses. We'll just have to wait for a moment and see. They've done well. Just two lionesses managed to bring down a relatively large sub-adult buffalo. And there is plenty of meat left still. Actually, almost looks like an adult female, just a young adult female. So some interesting things happening while I was on leave with the Nkuhumas. They seem to have, James described it as exploded. I'm not quite sure I would go that far, but they do seem to be incredibly scattered. And that was on its way to happening when I went on leave, with the one denning in Torchwood, the other looking incredibly pregnant, and we thought denning around Vubu Road, Gauri Cutline on Juma. We've got 2 out of 5 for now, I think. We'll just have to wait for a little bit to confirm if it is them. And obviously they've taken advantage of the incredible wind that's been blowing over the last 24 hours. This is lion and leopard heaven weather. We might not enjoy it as human beings. Maybe we don't enjoy it because there's an instinct within us that tells us that this is good predator weather. Unfortunately for this poor buffalo, it has not done it any favours. I have to tell you, we're not very far from where we saw that baby buffalo yesterday morning on the Sunrise Safari. So when I heard that they had a buffalo kill, I approached with a considerable degree of trepidation. I was utterly terrified it was going to be the female buffalo that we watched struggle yesterday before she managed to get up and move her newborn calf. But it's not her. It's definitely not her.
which is a very human thing for me to say. I shouldn't really say that. You can't judge one buffalo more valuable than the other. But we did become, emotionally, all of us, from Brian and myself, the ladies in final control, and of course all of you watching, we did become quite emotionally involved in that story. That doesn't look like amber eyes.
Cheers, guys. Thanks very much.
Just saying thank you to Warren, who provided us with this extraordinary sighting. What a lovely surprise. This day has just been full of surprises.
Oops, somebody found a stump on their way out.
There's a distinct crunching sound that was definitely not lion nibbling on buffalo. There we go. Two cats have had, well, actually more than that. Five cats, if we count Karula and her two cubs, plus the two lionesses, have definitely had a good Saturday. Find themselves with a delicious meal. Oh, and Shadow. Well, we've done well today. We've had Tundi, a male lion, Karula and cubs again, Shadow, and the two Nkuhuma lionesses. What a wonderful day to be out in the bush. Definitely worth braving the cold for. And she's definitely making short work of the buffalo's hip joint. Okay, well, that movement of the other vehicle gives us a chance to reposition and get a view of the other lioness. Oh, goodness, it is so windy. And I can probably stop cupping the microphone now because it's just us. But I'm going to keep it here anyway because it's so windy. Donna, you were wondering if the new cubs have been seen yet? No, they haven't. It's just the Nkuhuma cubs that were born on Torchwood have been seen. They must be of the age very soon where we will start to see them moving out and about, which is so exciting because lion cubs are amazing. Dave, have you seen lion cubs?
Not yet.
No. So Dave's got something very exciting to look forward to. It'll be the first time he's filmed lion cubs while he's been at Wild Earth. Yep. Oh, no, hold on. We're not going to reposition. Oopsie. Hello. We've got Henry arriving. Now I just want to show him the best way to go into the sighting, so just bear with me for 1 second.
Hi guys.
Hello,
how are you? Good, thanks. I think your best approach might be to actually go back onto power lines. Warren had a good position from in there. So if you come through this way with your nose in this way, it might be a little bit easier. Because our view is not fantastic, but I think you'll get a good one from that side. Cool.
There we go. All done. Just helping one of the other vehicles come through. A couple of months ago, we were treated to the most extraordinary exhibition of the Nkuhuma Pride's hunting ability, and that was when we went out after drive with just Nikki, Kirsty and myself. We ended up being treated to an incredible but quite heart-wrenching sighting where the lionesses caught a calf and proceeded to eat it while it was still alive. It's very difficult to watch when something like that happens. Now, Virginia, you were wondering, do they always eat their prey alive? Or will they kill it first? Interestingly, it seems to depend on the size of the animal that they have killed. So if it's something small, it's not strong enough to throw the lionesses off or for them to risk being injured. Whoopsie, where'd he go? Oh, he went through that way. Okay, fair enough. It wasn't quite what I meant in terms of my directing, but that's okay. Whoopsie. Oh dear. He's not going to be terribly happy when he realizes that he can't get in that side. Oh well. Oh dear, I thought he would see the tire tracks. Anyway, Virginia, if it's a larger animal, like a big buffalo bull,
The lions have to kill it first, because if they don't, they run the risk of it struggling free and then actually injuring them, kicking them in some way or thrashing them with their horns. Sorry, Henry, how's your view there? Another conversation happening. It's something very difficult to watch. It's important to remember that the animals don't live by our code of morality. It's survival of the fittest. So the lions will only really go about killing them. And it's usually, unfortunately, quite a slow death, because it's death by strangulation, almost inevitably, which often in a way takes longer than being eaten alive. It's a very brutal reality. But you can't love nature without taking the good with the bad. And somewhere one of these lionesses, or two of these lionesses, have little babies to feed. And most likely, those that haven't had cubs yet are probably pregnant at this point. They've all been mating with the Birmingham boys, one stage or another. They will all be pregnant. Up we get. Enough of that for now. It's the Nkuhuma female. Look at that belly. Dave, can we zoom in on her belly quickly, please? Let's have a look at that nipple at the back. This is the lioness that looks so incredibly pregnant. Okay, not suckle marks just yet. Or is that a suckle mark? You see the ring around the nipple? It doesn't look... I'm not sure. I'm not 100%. Wow, well done, Dave. Thank you. Close examination. I don't think so. I don't think so yet. And look at the bulge that's around. Oh, thanks, girl. She got shy. I don't think she's had her cubs yet, but this lioness is also pregnant. That bulge at the back of her belly. Now, Brock, the lionesses, or the lions, are actually having an easier time than they do during summer. So Brock wanted to know whether or not it is harder or easier, or harder for a lioness, or lions, sorry, try that whole sentence again. Brock would like to know if it's harder for the lions to hunt in winter because there's less cover. And the answer is no, although I can definitely see what you mean by that, because of course there's less vegetation for them to hide behind. But the truth is, winter is, especially in a drought, is the time of the predators, because it's our dry season, which means all of the general game, their prey species, are concentrated around whatever water there is left. Something like a water-dependent animal like a Cape buffalo has to keep moving towards water, and essentially the lions just have to patrol the regular pathways, because the animals don't have any choice but to go and drink at the dams. So no, winter is actually an easier time for the lions to hunt. She's making sure that she's got all of the parts of the most nutritious part of the buffalo, which is, of course, its internal organs, rasping away with an incredibly rough tongue that's actually capable of stripping the meat away from the bone. MJ's asked the question that I think we're all thinking about. How long do we think they've been feeding on this buffalo carcass? MJ? Actually, you know, now that we're looking at it, they've eaten the organs, which they always do first, and they've eaten just a little bit of the rump. I would say maybe not more than a couple of hours. I even would go so far as to guess that they were not here this morning, just because of the amount that they have consumed. But I could be wrong. They might even have been here on the sunrise drive, right next to the road. And it's just one of those things. If you don't drive down the right road sometimes, you miss whatever's on it. which is inevitable. I wonder if these girls were responsible for some of the noise we heard last night. Those of you who were watching the Juma Dam camera must have heard the lion roars. We know at least one of them was a male, that male that was around Twin Dams with James. And it might also, he might also have been joined by the females. She's having a fantastic meal. Deborah, our armchair traveller, as we watch our pregnant Nkuhuma feeding away. Deborah's asked this morning about leopard gestation period, and she apologised for asking that. And now she's asked about lions and has apologised again. Deborah, please don't apologise. It hasn't been discussed, and it's a very nice comparison point. So a lion gestation period is very, very similar to that of a leopard. It's just ever so slightly longer, but I'm talking only by a few days. So a lion gestation period, again, between 90 to 100 days, up to 105 days, depending upon the individual concerned. I can't believe this female, if it's the same one, is still pregnant. She's been looking distinctly uncomfortable for what feels like almost a month. But perhaps it's a different lioness. It's starting to get difficult to keep track of them. The pregnant lioness I saw is the young lioness with the two dots on her nose, at the bottom of her nose. So this might be a different lioness. She's a little bit covered in buffalo for me to be able to see and identify her. And the other lioness, thinking about getting up, but for the moment, sleeping away a very full stomach, hidden behind the trees. Sorry guys, I've just been listening to the Game Drive channel. And while we watch our lionesses with their newly-ish acquired meal, Tom and Jenny from Illinois, welcome to the Sunset Safari. You wanted to know how often lionesses like this will have a big feed. I'm just going to cut my microphone over here. The answer is they usually eat about once every 3 days, but that depends on what they catch. So if they catch something like a buffalo, if a male doesn't come along and steal most of this, they'll probably be here for another day or so feeding on this carcass, possibly even another day and a half. And then they don't need to eat for another 3 days, right up to another 7 days before they might catch their next meal. So very variable in the lion world. There's only so many animals, that only so many successful hunts that they can carry out in a period of time. But the rough average is around once every 3 days. Ooh, big stretch. I'm not sure if you could hear that there, but she gave a little bit of a groan. Ooh. Family dinners can be fraught with peril in the lion world. And this lioness is going to have to find a nice feeding spot or else risk being battered about by the other lioness. Even though they do have relatively full bellies, they're still, it's the initial, when the kill is initially made, that you'll find that lions fight the most over their kills. And it's the strongest eat first. There's no sort of tender caring for the cubs, letting them come in and have their full first. Yeah, it's the strongest lion for themselves. The cubs eat last. And if there's a male around, he will take as much as he wants. He usually won't let the lionesses eat until he has a very full belly. Depending on the size of the kill, of course. while we watch our pregnant lion feed Gracie, who is 8 years old. I'm really, really happy to be back as well, so thank you for that. It's nice to be a girl out on safari, and I'm also really excited about watching the lion cubs play, and I can't wait to show them to you. They are definitely some of the cutest animals that we get out here. So not too long, Gracie. We're not going to have too long to wait before we get Nkuhuma cubs that we can watch playing about. And Gracie is, of course, a very special and one of our regular guests on safari. The one lioness hasn't quite got around to the feeding part. It's more a sort of resigned lying on the buffalo part. While she decides whether or not she's going to try and feed from here, let us find out what James is up to.
We've just turned off the road here, everybody. There were kudu going crazy. It's not far from where Shadow crossed. In fact, it's exactly where she crossed into Hoffman's over there. And I wonder if she hasn't come back, perhaps, because there's a kill here, because her cub's here. Maybe she's brought the cub back. They were looking around here, but we can't see anything. Oh, I really thought we were going to bump into Shadow again. We might still. The kudu was standing right where I am now, or where we are now. What they were yelling at, I don't know. Very, very cross they were. They were staring into this area here. We drove through there. We didn't see anything. Oh well, what a stroke. We've had an incredible afternoon, really, especially given the weather. Just keep an eye on the air. There were little ones looking this way, but the adults were all staring this way. I don't know. It's possible that they just saw her on the main road. The main road's not far from here. But they were looking right into here, and there's a nice termite mound there. But we went past that termite mound, and we didn't see nothing. Yeah, well, this tends to be the way it goes. Unless you bump these things, they tend to be impossible to find. We'll just ease our way through here. Now, Deborah, quite apart from what you observe in the winter or the summer, Deborah, normally during at least the winter, because the leaves are falling off the trees, and so the bush is that much less thick than it would be otherwise. We're just going to drive around quickly around here and see if we don't pick something up, and then we'll go back around that way. It's quite a large block. So as you can see, I mean, the bush is thinning because of the lack of water. And we saw Shadow crossing. We saw Shadow crossing about 450 feet up the road here. Just wondering if she hasn't come back with her little baby. And maybe that's what those kudu were shouting at. Yeah, in the summertime, you know, it's really actually quite a lot more difficult because the water's not as concentrated. And so there's, you know, animals can go and drink anywhere at all. Now, here's a nice game path. But it's almost impossible. You know, I got out of the car to go and look for the tracks where we last saw her, and I couldn't find one, and that's because of the light. You'd think I'd be able to spot something that's close to the ground, but they cannot. Oh well, we'll keep fossicking about here and see what we can find. All right, let's go back to the lions with Jamie, and I'll keep you posted on what we find here.
I'm sure you were all waiting in eager anticipation to find out what the second lioness was going to do, and the answer is fall asleep cuddling the buffalo. Seems to be the approach that she has adopted. Face to face with the kill, she's decided that actually she can't really be bothered to try and open up the second part of the carcass, and really she'd rather just have a nap. I suppose fair enough. It does look a bit odd though, that scene in front of us. The lions, I've heard from one of our viewers that lions actually rest their paws like that because it takes pressure off their full bellies, which I feel is an entirely valid possibility. That's why her paw is up on the end like that, up in the buffalo. Now what we're going to do, for those of you with queasy stomachs, just a fair warning, we're going to have a little bit of a closer look at the lioness's face, see if we can't figure out who she is. So those of you who don't like blood and gore, now would be the time to look away while we get a little bit closer in there and just have a look if we can't see which lioness we're watching. It's really tricky to tell though, because she is quite thoroughly coated in bits of buffalo that she's been chewing on. Now Marianne, while we watch this lioness feed, it does give us an incredibly raw image that we're watching. We wanted to know, if a lion's make a kill far from water, will they be able to obtain the moisture that they need from their kills, or will it make it worse? And I can completely see where you're coming from with that in terms of the idea of it being quite a salty business, eating a buffalo, and therefore the moisture content might not get them what they need. They do, however, get a great deal of moisture from their kills, as do leopards, and they're very well equipped at dealing with it. The lions, when they can, they'll drink once a day, and they're relatively water dependent, but they are adapted to live in more arid, drier climates, so they don't have to necessarily drink every day. And a lot of the moisture that comes through from the blood is of a sort of a pH that's not going to cause them extra dehydration, or at least it's got a salt content that's not going to cause them extra dehydration. So they do get a little bit of moisture. That being said, they're quite happy to walk a large distance to go and have a drink. What they'll often do is kind of have one of them on standby to look after the carcass, and the rest will go and drink, and then they'll come back and the other will... Let's just listen, see if we get some growls. A very faint one. One of the lionesses. But yes, they'll kind of rotate. Sorry guys, I'm going to have to repeat actions from earlier and just help Andrew come in here. That was done purely by sign language there, which I think we achieved relatively well. I think we understood each other. We'll see. In a moment we should be hearing Andrew approaching from the opposite direction. Hopefully things don't go wrong this time round. Here's a wonderful piece of information for you. Aileen, who is one of our regular viewers, believe it or not, you've been thinking on very similar, along very similar lines to Viam was this morning. So Aileen was wondering, do I think that a pregnant lioness eats less or can gorge herself less when she's very pregnant simply due to the economics of space? Sorry, guys. Andrew, there's an entrance point a little bit just behind where you've come past that I think might get you the best view. So sorry, guys. This sighting has caused something of confusion in terms of approaching it. So do I think a lioness eats less? Viam was actually asking that question in terms of, or in response to the sighting that we had with Tundi, who's also looking like she's going to drop cubs at any moment. It's sort of counterintuitive, isn't it? Because they need a lot more food. There's Andrew. They need a lot more food at that time of their life because they're sustaining not only themselves but also cubs. But you're right, I do think that they have less space to eat as much as they would like to. All of our predators, of course, have that fantastic ability to consume as much meat as possible. Good point, though. It is a very interesting question, and it's fascinating that it's been raised twice today with two different animals. Hello, Andrew. Guests enjoying a view of the lionesses. And she's actually giving us a nice view of her. Oh, here we go again. There's going to be some grumbling, but I don't think there's going to be any fighting between these two females. They've both got full enough bellies that it's not really worth the energy. She's just going to growl a little at her. She still wants to get to that bit of carcass. That's actually really where she wants to be, but she's going to content herself with the stomach cavity. She's showing such reticence to actually go about this whole process. Still a bit too, or at least not all that keen to stick her head in there. So instead, this time, she's adopted the even more comfortable position of lying on top of the buffalo's front legs. And actually, since we're here and we don't often get to look at the bottom of buffalo's hooves, something nice for people to do is, whenever you look at an animal track, to try and picture what the animal's hoof looks like when you see it. So have a look there, the back track. You can kind of see the overlap between the two toes that make up the hoof. And you can see one is slightly in front of the other, and that actually shows up in the track itself. There you go, there's that slight overlap that we get in between the groove. And if we scan a little way further to the left now, to the front feet that our lioness is lying on. We have a look there. A little bit. There we go. If we have a look at the bottom, or the underside of the buffalo's hoof, you've actually got a really nice idea of what sort of shape a hoof like that would leave in the sand. And it's a really nice way of learning the different tracks, because once you've looked at the bottom of a buffalo's hoof like that, won't ever forget what their track will look like. And since our lionesses are going to be here for a while, let's go and find out how things are going at the Arethusa International Airport.
Well, those Impala were just thinking about having a bit of a fight to warm up, I think, everybody. Look at them sizing each other up. They keep semi-making that roaring noise. We didn't find anything else around where those kudu were, so we're just sort of doing a wider circle. And why we were doing that? Well, look what's going on here. What we call argy-bargy. Much more argy than bargy at the moment, though. I think one of them is a little bit scared, to be honest. And the only reason he's turning round. See how they're making sort of half-hearted roaring noise. And I've got to tell you, the speed at which they're reacting, even though this looks like a pretty innocuous interaction, notice how as soon as one looks like it's going to move its head, the other one does the same thing. They're watching each other and sizing each other up constantly. And even now, as he looks at us over his left shoulder, he's watching that other chap. And now they'll just wait and see. And you can see them doing that semi-roaring. Oh, there we go. It's trying to catch each other off guard. It's a very odd time for them to be fighting, and I suspect that they've been put on edge by this wind that's blowing through the place. You can see it blasting the trees from side to side. And that, I think, is it. Right, on the other end of the airstrip, of course, we've got a whole herd of impala which are waiting to get out of here. And as you can see, I don't think they're all going to fit on the plane, and so some of them are going to be very disappointed. It's only a sort of 16-seater at maximum. Not even that. Hello, Katie in South Bend, Indiana. I'm going to assume that you perhaps know Lucy in South Bend, Indiana. You want to know if the drought has affected the tourism of the area at all? Have any of the lodges had to close because of it yet? No, not yet. It could happen, but at the moment the drought's actually a bit of a boon because the game viewing is so very good at the moment. But yes, it could absolutely happen that things could become so dry that the wells that feed the water, feed the lodges, the boreholes will dry up. See that herd of impala there now moving off into the woodland, a huge herd of females and their little ones. And they've just been walking around the wheels and wings of that Pilatus plane, that's what that is, I think. And as VM says, it ain't going nowhere in this wind. Sorry, chaps, obviously their flight's been delayed, so they're heading off into the woodland again. I'm going to continue down this road now. It's the same road that we were on, and it leads out of Arethusa, but I'm just wondering if whatever that kudu was looking at might not be coming along here. We'll go and have a look-see. We really, like I was saying last time, we've had a remarkable time given the weather. And Jen from Belito, nice to have somebody from South Africa watching us and talking to us. Sorry, go again with that, Kirsten. All I'm getting is Lynn. Ian. Hello, Ian from, not Jen, Ian from Belito. You are interested in warthogs and you say you've heard that they're the ones that suffer the most from the drought. They're the first to suffer, Ian, because they are water dependent and they are obviously not built to migrate. They've got very short little leggies and so they can't go migrating to huge distances to water. So around the water holes, if there's sufficient forage for them, then they'll be fine. But yeah, once the forage drops below a certain quality and once the water dries out, they can get into very bad trouble indeed. Look, and you read about this, that's what you read. But during the height of the dry season last year, it wasn't the warthogs that really suffered. They hung around the water holes, they seemed to be okay. Some of them got a bit skinny. One of them got very skinny and died, but I think she was sick. The rest of them did okay. It was actually the impala and the wildebeest and the buffalo, to me, that seemed to suffer the most. So it seemed to be the grazing, the exclusive grazers and mixed feeders that really seemed to suffer the most during the last part of the drought. Now, whether that will continue or not, I don't know. But as I say, because we're now going into the, well, we're into the business end of the dry season, and it's at the end of a very poor rainy season, so it's now that the animals are going to start to sort of show signs of distress, I think. We had that little bit of rain and that little sprout of growth that seemed to provide a bit of impetus and give it everything health. Now that's gone. And Cindy, you're in Florida wondering about the forage that's falling off the trees and is it any good? Well, we tried some the other day. It tastes profoundly different from the forage that is on the trees, so the leaves that are on the trees. And I suppose it's got some nutritional value. I suspect it's largely roughage value. I don't know that there's too much actual nutrition in the fallen dead leaves, but some animals will be able to eat them, and certainly, you know, all of the termites will eat them, and the invertebrate life that tries to survive through the winter, they will most certainly eat the leaves that have fallen out of the trees. It's a nice question, Cindy. Well, we're back into the area where those kudus were shouting. But I see no predators. And as Wim was saying, it could well have been just a hyena walking through the area. It was just so very close to where Shadow was. Anyway, we'll go and do one more drive past where Shadow went into the block there, and then we'll go back to Juma and see what we can find there. Nothing on the radio here going on at Arethusa. I think you have, area-wise, for this area, we've had, between Jamie and I, the best possible result with Karula and cubs. And in fact, as Wim was saying, we've had the entire Karula lineage today. Karula and her daughters and her other daughters and her sisters, which are also her daughters, which is slightly disconcerting, of course. Now we'll just turn onto this main road. We did see a car coming past here. We'll do one reverse down here. James Bear, please do not worry. You say you're beginning to worry about the state of the trees and when are the animals going to start debarking them given the lack of leaves. Well, they've started already. There's absolutely no doubt that they have started debarking the trees already, the elephants, James, and that's normal. That will happen. And we were talking about the destructive nature of animals earlier on and saying that it's entirely normal for them to push trees over and debark them and kill them, and that's just how it happens. And it's not a problem, because that's how this ecosystem has evolved. So yes, to our naked eye, it might look a little destructive and unpleasant. It's completely normal. So James, I don't think you should be worrying about the trees. It's getting dark suddenly, isn't it, Liam? Yes. There's a very big cloud coming in from the west now. I don't know why it's coming in from the west, or the wind is blowing the other way. Anyway, I think we're going to pack up this search now. We saw her once. All right, we're going to have one more pass through this area. While we do that, let's go back to the lions with Jamil.
Well, we've discovered the reason for the second female's reticence in terms of feeding, and that is you don't want to come between a pregnant lioness and her food, very clearly, because every time this poor lioness tries to feed, she gets growled at and at one point swatted by the pregnant lioness. So what she's tried is a different tactic. She's basically, from where she was lying on the buffalo's hooves, she has, I don't know how to describe it, it's sidling. Those of you who have dogs that are not allowed on the bed, but they want to anyway, where they try to do that really subtle, slow climb, like if they do it really slowly, you're not going to notice them. That's exactly what she's done in trying to get her head into the buffalo's stomach cavity. She's snuck closer inch by inch by inch, and she's finally managed to find herself a position. It's not the best one. She kind of got the raw end of the deal here. Although I suppose, in this case, all of the ends of the deal are raw. But, oh dear. No, it's this wind. It's gone to my brain, Dave. But she doesn't really have much to feed on there. She's got the stomach cavity and the chest cavity. There's not all that much left. She's making the most of what she has. I think she's decided that risking a fight with a hormonal and very large lioness is maybe not the way forward. Her behavior, I don't know. I'm guessing. But I think it might be the younger lioness, the one that has only recently reached the stage at which I think we can start calling her an adult lioness rather than the sub-adult. But the younger female of the Nkuhuma pride, I think it might be her. Her spots are quite, the spots that all lions have, of course, around their legs and around their bellies, spots are still quite prominent, in my opinion. I think it might be the young lioness. She's got so big now, it's getting really difficult to tell the difference between the two. Shame. You can see she's really struggling to get the meager pieces of meat out from the back end of the buffalo there. What's interesting about the situation is, oh, head gone, head in buffalo. So the last drive I did with Dave was with two Nkuhuma lionesses, and we followed them to a buffalo kill that had been stolen by hyenas. It was the most extraordinary sighting, because we had the lionesses running away, they were outnumbered by the hyenas, and they had to abandon their kill, but with great annoyance, as you can imagine. Oh. Oh. Okay. Just making sure you know your place, young lion. The interesting thing is, this is one of the hyenas clan, or the hyena clan of Jumas. This is one of their favorite stomping grounds. We're on the, close to the western boundary of Juma. Now we don't know, we know where the new hyena mother is with her two new cubs. We don't know where the rest of the clan have decided to move to. My suspicion, judging by the tracks all over the show here, is they're not too far away. And as night starts to fall, it could turn into a very interesting scene, as these two lionesses might end up having to defend their kill. Now, if they're joined by a male, or some of the other females, then it'll become something of a moot point. They'll have the numbers and the strength to ward off any number of hyenas. And almost invariably, a hyena clan will not pick a fight with a pride that has a male in attendance, or a couple of males in attendance, unless they are really, really desperate. It's not worth the hassle of riling up a big male lion of 400-odd, more than 400-odd pounds. Oh, this wind is getting worse. I've sort of discovered that if I duck right down into the cavity of the car, I can watch what the lionesses are doing on the monitor, and at the same time shelter from the wind with my hood up. Poor old Dave, of course, doesn't have that luxury. Dave doesn't have a choice. Dave has to sit at the top there and be exposed. Dave's wearing a palaclava. And Lucy in South Bend, Indiana. Good afternoon and welcome to the Sunset Safari. Apparently, James asked you to ask me how much the leaves have changed since I went on leave. And the answer is it's absolutely incredible. I think it was one of the first things I noticed when I got back here, was how all of the bush willows, like the one that we are currently sitting, not quite underneath, but almost underneath, of how much the bush willows have changed a colour. And they really, truly have. They've gone from a sort of yellow-green, as this one is, to almost all of them being completely orange and brown and dropping their leaves all over the show. Now, the change in... When did I go on leave? It was... I've already lost track of it now. Last week, just 10 days ago, more than 10 days ago, or about 10 days ago. The change in 10 days is absolutely phenomenal. It's amazing how fast things change out here. Sorry, I just heard a low rumble off from my right. Let us see what is happening here. Pregnant lady is up once again. That growl... I don't think you'll be able to hear it now above the wind, but it's the sort of low vibrating sound, and it's the same growl that they often give as a warning if you accidentally walk too close to them, if you happen to bump into them by mistake. It's that deep rumbling sound, and it's a truly awe-inspiring thing. Terius, who is a new viewer, has commented that this lady, presumably me, definitely not Dave, that this lady is sitting watching lions feast on a corpse just a few feet away from her. What's the amazing thing about where we are? So we're on a reserve called Juma. We operate on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains. It all falls under the Sabi Sand area in the Great Kruger National Park. So we're right up in the northeast corner of South Africa. And what's really cool about it, what's really unique about it is that it is completely live. Now, South Africa is probably one of the best destinations in terms of wildlife viewing, just because our animals are so relaxed in our company. As you see. It was great timing, wasn't it? Isn't that such a cool moment? When they walk right past you, is the second one going to come and do that to me too? Oh, it's elephants, that's why. There's an elephant. Where's the lion gone, Dave?
He's just behind us, yeah.
Oh, cool. So she's decided to seek refuge behind us. I'm very grateful for that. Especially with several tons of elephant walking through. They're coming, they're going to come out onto the road here. I thought I heard an elephant. She definitely heard an elephant. She heard it before I did. There we go. And that's why our big pregnant lioness moves off. She knows that she doesn't quite have the agility that she used to in her non-pregnant state. And she doesn't want to tangle with a mother elephant and her herd. I'm relatively certain the elephants that just walked past us were the herd of the snared trunk female. That female that we've got to know over recent times. So I never finished talking about how comfortable the animals are, but I didn't need to because a lion just walked right past the car. Now, our other lioness has taken advantage of the pregnant female's rapid departure and has claimed her chance to feast off the best part of the buffalo. That was awesome. Such a perfect demonstration of how wonderful the animals of the Sabi Sands are. That being said, they're wild animals. They are 100% wild. I would absolutely not get out of the vehicle now. I absolutely would not underestimate them. And it's a constant reminder of just how powerful these creatures really are. And they're treated with absolute respect. I would never have driven that close to her. She was comfortable because she chose to come up to me and past me. I must say, she took me somewhat by surprise there. I didn't actually see her get up. But isn't that incredible? One of those joys of the live safaris is that because they're wild and because it's live, you never know what direction things are going to take you in. And I think it's time, the time has come, earlier than normal because it's so cloudy, to throw a little bit of light into this situation. That's a pleasure, Dave. Oh, hold on, there's an eagle being mobbed by lapwings. Goodness, it's all happening here. This is the place to be. Well done, Dave. It was a big eagle, it was a tawny eagle. And the lapwings did not take kindly to its presence. Amazingly brave little birds. Ah, this is definitely the place to be on Juma today. Elephants, eagles, lapwings, lions, one slightly, well, half a buffalo. I think she's quite happy that the other lioness moved. She definitely doesn't have the same full belly, so she's not been afforded the same opportunity to eat as much as she wanted to. Is this the young lioness? I think it might be. So while I puzzle over that, I'm relatively certain that it is. And we wait for our pregnant lioness to get brave enough to rejoin us. Let's go back over to James for an update.
Yum. I'm sorry, everybody. My cameraman seems to be asleep today. We've seen two dike now, and all that.
The light to the left.
No, the light was there. I can't shine the light on the dike. It's very desperate working with this man tonight. Well, Jamie has had all the luck today. Well, not all of it, but a substantial proportion, and I think that's marvellous. It's been a really good afternoon. We gave up, I'm afraid, on where we heard those alarm calls. We'll go back there in the morning and see if we can't pick up perhaps Shadow and her little cub sharing a kill there. It'd be so nice to see them. Anyway, for the moment, what we're going to do now, well, I was going to go to the hyena den, but it's got a bit dark. What we're going to do is head down towards the Jumadam Pan, so keep your eyes on the camera there, and see if that lion from today has not popped out. I'm amazed that he didn't hear that buffalo being murdered earlier on. I don't know how much of the buffalo's left, but I suspect that those lionesses killed it sometime during the day, because I think none of us actually drove up there this afternoon, so I don't know how old the buffalo kill is. Maybe Kirsten can give me some kind of indication. No, she can't. Well, so we'll just guess that it was killed out of earshot of that big lion, because he definitely would have gone in there. Male lions, of course, the greatest scavengers of the bush. Okay, we're going to ease our way sort of down through this way onto quarantine and see if that male hasn't come out. And the wind continues to howl from the southwest. That's basically down there, everybody. That's the southwest there. And you can see, I don't know if you can see, but it looks quite misty, and I don't actually think that's mist. If you might zoom in if I might trouble you. Thank you so much. I don't mean to inconvenience you. That looks like mist. I don't think it is. I actually think it's dust brought up by the wind. So although it looks like there might be moisture in the air, I don't think that's what that is. Right, come on, Vim, we have to find something of worth. Otherwise, Jamie's going to get home and, well, she's the last person to be smug, but I'll just feel awful, you know. She's done it all. Perhaps a snake lurking on the branches somewhere would be nice. I'm also hoping that Karula and her youngsters will be still there in the morning. And we'll pop around there and have a look. Oops. Hello, Zoe. You're a new viewer, and it's lovely to have you with us. And if you do ask us a question, everybody, please do tell us if you are a new viewer, because it's always nice to know when we have new people watching with us. Zoe, you want to know if there are any animals that I'm afraid of? Zoe, there are a number of animals that I'm certainly wary of. Afraid, I think, is a dangerous thing to be out here. Wary is a good thing to be out here. You don't want to be afraid, because it tends to, I think it does impair your judgment slightly. I'm wary of elephants all the time. I'm wary of buffalo, especially if I'm on foot. I'm wary of the big cats. You know, it wasn't too long ago that Karula was charging vehicles. She was very upset with us. So I'm wary of just about everything. I'm wary of snakes. I suppose if there's one thing I'm afraid of out here, it would be getting malaria. And so mosquitoes make me afraid. And I would certainly be afraid if I came across a hippopotamus on foot and I happened to be in the between it and the water, then I would be immediately afraid. But no, I've got used to living out here, and so I don't think I'm afraid of anything necessarily. There's certainly situations that can make me afraid, but I'm not overtly afraid of anything, but I'm definitely wary of all the animals out here. And I think that's a relatively good position to be in. You don't want to be terrified, but you must always be wary. Never be complacent. And it's always good to remind ourselves of that. No matter how hard we do, obviously, so often, you know, I don't know, like that elephant sighting today, it's very easy to be complacent around the elephants of the Sabi Sands, because they can be extremely confiding, and they can, they often don't worry at all about us. But sometimes, if you read their behavior wrong and you are complacent, well, you can get yourself into trouble. And so we're very careful about that sort of thing. Nice question, Zoe. But remember, I mean, the other nice, interesting thing about that question is that what happens is that it's the danger of this area is built up. It's built up by stories. I've sat around many a fire with game rangers of this area telling stories of their bravery and the danger that they've subjected themselves to, or the danger that they were in. 9 times out of 10, those are all obviously blown out of proportion, and I've told those stories myself. And also, when they are serious danger, or where there has been serious danger, it's normally been the result of the guide or the ranger sort of doing a silly thing that he shouldn't have been doing. We're also very good at as guides, especially in our younger days before we've matured, we're very good at telling people how, giving the impression that what we do is a dangerous thing. So I remember meeting my guests for the first time, and I had with me this great big hunting rifle, you know, it was an enormous thing, 375 caliber Holland and Holland bolt action Breno, terrifying looking thing. You meet your guests, you've got your rifle, you've got your Land Rover, and people think, good grief, this guy's a, you know, he's a brave, well-trained fellow. Well, we were quite well-trained, I suppose, but I'm not sure how brave we were. I mean, we were in a car, and the dangers of it are not quite as big as you might think. And I always love the stories of these guys who carry these big knives in their belts. Men who, you know, they carry sort of huge knives in their belts as if to give the impression that at any stage something might leap out of the bush and they'll have to have at that thing with this enormous Excalibur-length sword pinned to their waists. And of course, nine times out of ten, it's just for show. It goes along with the rifle and the khaki clothes. And the used to be, thankfully, this tradition has changed, but the very short, tight khaki shorts, which I never had the legs for. So Zoe, that's the story of the danger out here. I think it's far less dangerous living where I live than it is living in a city, for example. And HK, you want to know how we stay safe from getting malaria. This is not a high-risk malaria area, HK. But what we do is we spray. You put spray on your skin if you want to, if you're a bit worried about that. We spray our rooms out every so often with an anti-mosquito repellent. Viam sleeps under a mosquito net. You do, don't you, Viam?
Yeah.
So that's a good thing to do in the summertime. Do you do it in winter, Viam?
Yeah, it depends how many mosquitoes are in
the room. Okay, so it depends how many mosquitoes are in his room as to whether he'll sleep under the net during the night time or not, at least during the winter time or not. Otherwise, you can't really take prophylactics. You can get homeopathic prophylactics that are seemingly very effective. But the best thing to do is to just put a bit of stuff on your skin. And you can take prophylactics if you come here on a visit. But we, living out here, can't take them on a full-time basis. Otherwise, we'd get very sick. Our livers wouldn't be able to cope with them. So that's how we deal with malaria, HK. I like to think on the subject of danger, because it's a bit of a bugbear of mine, I like to think that we are evolving as an industry, and by that I mean the guiding industry, into far more naturalist guides who appreciate all parts of nature and appreciate animals' behavior. Who was a bit of a yahoo in the bush, who didn't know a huge amount about the place and took chances and sort of provoked animals to charging and, you know, wore great big knives on their belts and that sort of thing to show how big and strong they were. I like to think we've evolved from that, but I don't know. All right, let's go back to the lions with Jamie. Very dangerous.
Well, that was well timed, because apparently James was just about to disappear off your screens regardless. We're still with our lioness, who is making short work of her buffalo and grabbing the opportunity whilst the other lioness has moved off. Our pregnant lioness got up and... Oh, hold on. This could get interesting. Dave, we're going to swing round. Hello. I wondered when you would show up. All right. Now, this is interesting. One hyena is not enough to chase a lioness off a carcass. That's where the second lioness went as well. I don't know where she disappeared off to. She moved. There's more elephants rumbling in the bushes. And now this could be interesting. I don't think a solitary hyena is going to be brave enough to chase away a lioness, but you never know. And it might be more than one. I'm going to keep an eye on what's happening further up the road. What that hyena is going to do now, He's going to circle far enough away that the lioness isn't too bothered by him, but he's basically going to be, he or she, it, is going to be scoping out how many lions there are and whether or not it's worth calling the rest of the clan to come and join him. She's shifted around slightly. I don't think she realized that there's a hyena wandering through. She's going too soon, though, although it's so windy that she might not. I wonder where that second lioness went. I don't think she would have gone far. I think she just moved to find a more comfortable position. Oh, she's just chased it away. Can't see it. Hold on. Okay, this could get interesting. I just heard the growl and then a hyena yip. In fright. I don't think it realized that the lioness was there. Neither did I, to be 100% honest with you. Didn't know exactly where she'd gone. Let's just go back and see if we can see what's happening. I think the hyena's probably long gone. Just heard a brrr and a yip. Further into the block. I'm going to stay with our view for now because all of the action is going to, if there is action, is going to center around the carcass. Okay. Back to our position in the bush willow. How's that there, Dave? Cool. Perfect. Okay. Alright, let's see how this scenario plays out. What's probably going to happen in the, during the course of the evening is that hyena is going to contact call and bring in reinforcements. And unless a male lion turns up, or the rest of the females, there's a very good chance that our Nguma ladies could lose their kill to the hyena clan of Juma. Just have to wait and see how this plays out. Lioness not going to be deterred. It is the young lioness, by the way. It's the female that we used to call the sub-adult female, who is now a fully grown adult female, but she's just that little bit smaller than the rest of the pride. Her crunching away, the usual sounds of our lions at night. I just want to get hold of Texan on the Game Drive channel and just let him know that he should come through now because there could be some interesting things happening. Tex, are you still coming to the Singala sighting? Okay guys, while I just have a quick discussion on the Game Drive channel, let's head back over to James.
Now, we are knocking about here on Ingwe Alley, which means Leopard Road, or Leopard Alley. We know that Karula is not here, but I'm hoping that lion was coming this way. He was sort of heading this way earlier when we left him this morning. Maybe he'll pitch up here. Ah, James Bear, that's very, very well observed by you. You say, why does the antenna look like a porcupine quill? Well, Viam very cleverly disguised it. And, I mean, look, he didn't disguise it, but he made it much less obvious than it used to be. That when it was sort of chrome-colored, it got in the way of every shot. And now if you zoom in far enough past the antenna, you hardly notice it in the shot. So that's why. It's just trying to sort of lessen the effect of the shiny metal. And one day we'll have it sorted out that the aerial actually sits on the back of the vehicle. But at the moment what happens is if you put the aerial on the back, the broadcast signal interferes with the actual radio signal and becomes impossible to hear what Kirsten Max Smith is saying. And good grief, you don't want to incur her wrath. If she thinks you're not listening to her, you get into a lot of trouble. There's an effluent. They're just going to go past you, my friend. We're not going to disturb you. You turn off these lights. It's just over there. A young bull. He's much more afraid of us. I was just thinking, before we linked back to Jamie, of course, and we're not supposed to be seeing that elephant, so that's why we didn't shine on him. Just because it's not nice to shine on elephants, they get very upset with the light. I was just thinking, we were talking about danger earlier with Zoe, and of course I was talking about the new kind of guide. And as I said that, I thought to myself as I linked to Jamie, that is precisely the kind of guide that we are trying to cultivate in the industry. She's the kind of new generation, if you like. Nerves of steel, but no need to show them, if you know what I mean. No need to demonstrate any kind of macho behavior. And she's the kind of guide I think that most new guides could look up to and take their cue from, especially men. They could learn a lot from Jamie Patterson. I know I have. Ruth, I love this question. You say, how important is it to wear khaki or olive drab on safari? Ruth, it's largely a fashion statement, to be honest. It's good not to wear too brighter clothes. Animals are largely colorblind, but if you wear something reflective, like if I wear a bright red jacket that's got shiny material, it will reflect light more and that will get animals' attention. But if it's kind of a matte red or a matte yellow and it doesn't reflect light more than anything else, then I don't think it makes a difference. We wear khaki because it looks good. I wear gray. I wear this gray. I chose this gray specifically because I think gray, if you want to be camouflaged out here, I mean, not that it's that necessary that I'm camouflaged driving a great big vehicle that makes a huge noise, but if you want to be camouflaged, I think gray is a very good color to be. The elephants are gray, and they disappear into the bush very nicely. If you are walking, yes, you want to be quite, you don't want to be too obvious. So like a bottle green, olive, gray, a sort of matte blue, if you like, not navy, but maybe a slightly brighter than navy color. That's a good color to be. So often khaki fades to a palish brown, which actually is like a beacon out here. You can see people wearing khaki like VM's got a shirt that he likes to wear that looks very good, it looks wonderful, but if you see him, you'll see him walking through the bush, it's like he's got a light shining on him. And that is the case with a lot of the kind of fashionable khaki stuff that you can buy these days. And you see, I mean, I used to find it profoundly amusing when you'd come down, you'd meet people out of an aeroplane, and the whole family would get out of the aeroplane, and they'd all be in matching khaki safari gear. But it would be this pale color that sort of shone in the African sunshine. And, well, it matched the uniforms that we used to wear, which was large, almost purely for show, because you can't have a ranger dressed in drab gray. It don't look so good. All right, we're going to just peep down here at the Juma Dam cam, and while we do that, let's go back to the lions. What?
While James makes his way across to the Juma Dam pan, we actually may well have to leave our lioness relatively soon. And that's just because there's other vehicles that want to make an approach, and since we've spent a sizable period of time with them, it's time for us to let others have a chance. Let me just
I'll make your approach. Okay, just telling Aubrey that he can come and join us. And I know that Texan is not far behind him. What we will do is as soon as Tex is close, we will pull out and let him enjoy the sighting. Now for new viewers, the reason that we can shine the light on the lions, and this is also to answer Molly's question, the reason why we can shine the lights on the lions without them being bothered is because as nocturnal animals, the light doesn't in any way hamper their ability to see in the dark. They have a very, very reflective membrane at the back of their retina called the tapetum lucidum, which bounces back the light and basically is capable of dealing with light in all kinds of conditions. That's why we shine on nocturnal animals like lions and leopards, but we won't shine spotlights on diurnal animals, like, for example, buffalo. There's the lioness. I don't think there's any way you'll be able to see her, but I think that this spotlight, the guys have found her at the back. She's behind the squarry bush, which is unfortunately the thickest tree that we have. So Molly, that's why the lions aren't bothered by the light. They've also, throughout their lives, got used to safari vehicles shining lights on them. That being said, it's very important to spotlight ethically. First of all, you don't need to shine it right in the animal's face. Next to them is just fine. You sort of bounce back the light. And you also need to be very, very careful when they are hunting. So you can imagine if you are a nocturnal animal, you're trying to creep up on a diurnal animal like an impala or a buffalo, and all of a sudden there's this incredibly bright light illuminating you. You can imagine how that will negatively affect their hunting. The other vehicles are on their way to finding the other lioness. Nearly there. Obviously she's decided to take a little bit of a break at the back behind. I think that hapless hyena in the wind could smell that there was a kill somewhere near, but obviously didn't realize just how close he came to having a a brush with death, so to speak. Because the lioness, if she had been bothered, if she hadn't been so pregnant, if she'd been a bit faster and a bit more agile, she probably could well have killed that hyena. Most of the time, however, the conflicts between our big predators, our top five predators, actually end with the parties going off in opposite directions, and sometimes even watching each other from a comfortable distance. Nothing out here wants to risk injury, because it means the difference between life and death. Unfortunately, I don't think I can reposition in any way to get us a better view. I was going to find out where Tex is. Make sure he's not coming up behind us. He did say he was coming from Impala Plains. I'm sure it's fine. I'll hear him when he comes through. What an extraordinary Saturday this has been. Lions and leopards all over the show. You really are quite thoroughly spoilt. Ooh, let's get some nice... It's a pity she has hidden the carcass behind the guari bush now. I was about to say let's get some side lighting, but maybe not. Perhaps not. We've got a view here of sorts. Well, hopefully these females manage to defend the carcass throughout the evening from other hyena, and they will be here with us tomorrow morning on the sunrise safari. There's plenty of meat left. They should still be around. It just depends on whether or not they manage to defend it. We might even find upon our return tomorrow morning, that they have been joined by some of the missing number of their pride. All right, guys, it is time for us to leave. There are other vehicles making an approach. So what we're going to do is we're going to pull out and let them have a turn. Unfortunately, we couldn't quite make it to the end of the sunset safari, but we've got plenty of opportunities to see them once again. So we come across to the end of our sunset safari. It's been an incredible day, and I'm so glad we got to share it with all of you. Thanks, Dave, for your fantastic camera work, and thank you to the lovely ladies in Final Control. Thank you to you all for joining us, for your questions and your comments and your company. Have a great day. We'll catch you tomorrow. Cheers.
There's a gerbil in there, everybody, a little bushveld gerbil. And I don't know where it is now. Can you see it moving, Vim? It's right in the middle of the screen, apparently. Really? Kirsten says she can see it. There it is. There it is. There he is. Can you see him there, everybody? Sort of bottom left quadrant, moving around. Let me try and move slightly back, because he's quite a sweet little fellow. He's a chestnut-coloured little gerbil that Viam spotted. If we get a good sighting of this, of course, it'll make up for everything we didn't find, don't you think, Viam? As everybody was desperate to see a gerbil. I'm afraid I don't see it there. No, let's carry on. Anyway, bushveld gerbil, everybody. Highlight of the day. Not quite. Karula's babies may have been the highlight of the day again. Anyway, we're just easing our way around. I keep saying easing. I'm going to stop saying it as of now. We're making our way around to the Gallagher waterhole. See if that lion didn't pop out there. He didn't pop out anywhere else where we would have been. Just 2 minutes. I hope we do it. Aren't you desperate to find him, Dean? Is that a snake or a plant? Sorry about that, everybody. It's just that little dip there. Come around the corner. There must be a lion here somewhere. Is he? I'd be amazed if he doesn't find those lionesses on their buffalo tonight. And I'm sure they'll have to share it with him, because he's bigger than them, you see. Around the corner. One minute to find the lion. He's not at the waterhole. Beastly fellow. Let's continue around here. I think he's gone south, you know. I think he's gone in the opposite direction. Probably towards Chitwa, where those Styx lionesses are with their little cubbies. And hopefully we'll see them a bit more as well. Oh well, no lion for us tonight. Just have a brief listen here. The last of the wind blowing. Oh dear, I pulled out. No, we got 20 seconds. Phew, I wondered what had happened to Kirsten. Thank you, everybody, for a wonderful afternoon. You bore with us, and it bore fruit, I would say. We saw a few things. Jamie saw some incredible things. We will see you tomorrow at 06:30. Until then, stay happy wherever you are in the world. Bye-bye.